This is a production of SDPB.
Touchdown! This is for a state championship. Oh, direct kick, and it's good!
There's going to be some highlights coming off of this.
The short-range jumper.
Edging out in lane four, the top seed.
This South Dakota High School State Championship event is conducted under the direction of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to day two of the Class AA Boys Basketball Tournament here on SDPB3. We are live at the Sanford Premier Center in Sioux Falls. I'm Steve Toome, he's JJ Hartigan. We're welcoming you to Consolation action this afternoon. Two games on the schedule today. It's an all Sioux Falls matchup, the Cavaliers and the Rough Riders in our first matchup, and then an all ESD grudge match for our second game, the Watertown Arrows taking on the Huron Tigers. And then coming up tonight, semifinal Friday night. We'll get the action started at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. Mitchell against Sioux Falls, Washington. And then it's Harrisburg against the Brandon Valley Lynx. That's the schedule for day two here at the AA Boys Basketball Tournament here in Sioux Falls. Our first matchup of the day, Roosevelt against the Cavaliers. These two teams met twice during the regular season, JJ. It was Jefferson winning both, combined margin 5 points.
Yeah, this is going to be a great matchup today. Two teams who are trying to erase poor shooting first halves and turn it around and try to put together a complete game today. Both teams yesterday shot well below their season averages in their opening half, but both were right around 50% in the second half, more to their true identities offensively. As you see some of their key wins that they got through this year, this Roosevelt team has had some challenges this year, notably three teams at the state tournament, Jefferson, Washington, and Huron. And you can see that they've had some close ones. That high-scoring affair against Washington back on December 30th showcases how good this offense can be. We saw how bad they can be yesterday, but that's not indicative of how they're going to play the rest of this tournament. We expect them to have a much better shooting day. Nasser Ishmael yesterday, that 5'8 senior guard, was terrific for this offense. He really kind of carried the team while everybody else got through some of their shooting woes. We would expect these other four guys, including Logan Nielsen, to have big games today. Hayden Goff actually looked pretty good, all things considered. They're expecting this big senior group to really lead the Rough Riders by example here this afternoon.
Yeah, Ishmael carried him on his back, 11 of his 13 points in the first half. Goff had 14 all in the second half, but it wasn't enough for Roosevelt to overcome Washington. Let's meet their opponents, the Cavaliers of Sioux Falls. Jefferson, they beat Rapid City Stevens in the SODEC 16 in overtime to get to the state tournament, and they had a rough shooting day against Mitchell, but came back. That was a close game, 69-61, the final score. As you see, Roosevelt, they played them on January 25th, won by three. They played them back on December the 9th and won 58-56. Yeah. So these two teams played twice, very close contest. And Mitchell, you know, I got to credit, Jefferson hung around with Mitchell and made that game pretty close, but Mitchell put him away in the end as a number one ranked team in the state.
Looking at the numbers in that game yesterday, Steve, again, first quarter, first half just didn't really go their way. They were 10 of 26 from the field in the first half, but they were 14 of 24 in the second half. They shot well above 50% in that second half. If they erase a poor shooting start to their day, it's a totally different game. They've also got to get their three-point shooting going. They shot right around 30% from deep yesterday. They'd like to see some threes go in early to establish that offense. Really, yesterday, the standout player, Damaris Fields, had a great game for this team. He was steady offensively throughout. Got to find a way to keep Braylon Bear out of foul trouble today, though, and Mason Payne, when he's really working the glass, this offense really flows. He is such a big part of their offense and what he does down low.
And when Jefferson was making their comeback, it was led by the efforts of Payne on the offense and defense as well. As you look at their marks, 15-7 for the Rough Riders, 12-10 for the Cavaliers, and four state titles for Roosevelt coming in 2000, 2014, 2021, and 2022. They were back-to-back champions with an amazing crew of athletes. We're about ready for the introduction of the starting lineups and all the pregame ceremonies. Let's turn it over to Mr. Greg Thompson. He is our public address announcer.
Good afternoon. The South Dakota High School Activity Association, along with its corporate partner, Lake Area Tech, welcomes you to this session of the State Boy AA High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activity Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you enjoy the game. Support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise as we honor the flag of our great country with the playing of our national anthem? Today, the national anthem will be played by the Del Rapids Pep Band, directed by Carla Polscher. We remind all in attendance that the proper respect is to remove your hat, face the flag, stand at attention with your right hand over your heart. Veterans in active duty, not in uniform, may salute the flag. Ladies and gentlemen, our national anthem. Welcome to session two. This game features the Rough Riders of Roosevelt and the Cavaliers of Jefferson. And now let's meet our starting lineups in alternating fashion. For the Rough Riders at guard, a 5'8 senior number two, Nasir Ismail. For the Cavaliers at guard, a 5'6 junior number two, Damaris Field. For the Rough Riders at guard, a 6-foot senior number three, Hayden Goff. For the Cavaliers at guard, a 6-1 senior number four, Tyler Bohannon. For the Rough Riders at guard, a 6-2 senior number four, Logan Nielsen. For the Cavaliers at guard, a 6-1 senior number 32, Dawson Sexer. For the Rough Riders at forward, a 6-3 junior number 13, Isaiah Garang. For the Cavaliers at guard, a 6-2 senior, number 34, Braylon Bear. And for the Rough Riders at center, a 6-5 junior, number 20, Akeem Moko. And for the Cavaliers at forward, a 6-4 junior, number 50, Mason Payne. The Rough Riders are led by Mitch Begeman, assistant coaches Luke Hanneman, Trey Waltner, and Jordan Waltman. The Cavaliers are led by Tim Reck. Assistant coaches Tanner Hillbrand, Jalen Snaza, Josh Thomas, Tanner Malachek, and Blake Barcher. Your officials for this game, Joe Beeler, Matt Cadwell, and Jeremy Grady.
And we are ready to get game number two underway here from the Sanford Premier Center. The Cavaliers in the home white uniforms, those rich, deep red uniforms for Roosevelt with the gold numbers and letters. It will be Payne and Moko standing in the center circle. 8 minutes on the clock. Game number one of day two is underway, and it will be Fields controlling the ball. Looking forward to the two number twos matching up. That's Fields and Ismail, two speedsters at the guard position. Sexer has it taken away by Ismail. He's on the move, but can't get around Sexer. And a man for Jefferson to start things off. Looks like it's going to be Sexer guarding Ismail out on the perimeter. Now the switch, and here comes the double team. Three man is Hoff. Garang. Oh, nice play to set up Garang in his first points of the afternoon. And it is the Rough Riders that strike first. Sexer, he plays some college football. USD, here's a shot from the corner, no good. Tipped out of bounds, they're gonna say it went off Moko. He and Payne were contesting that one.
Again, these two teams trying to quickly forget about poor shooting days yesterday. Less than 24 hours later for Jefferson back on the floor.
And here's the shot, it's an air ball and a good box out by Garang on the miss by Damaris Fields. He had 16 points yesterday, top scorer for the Cavaliers.
Yeah, he was 50% from the field yesterday, 7 of 14, hit two of his six three-point shots. Got into a little bit of foul trouble in that game and did have five turnovers. Taking good care of the basketball, that's going to be a point of emphasis today for Jefferson as they hang with this Roosevelt offense.
Goff misses on the three. There's Moko working against Payne, and he's going to draw a foul and some free throws.
This is a guy they need to get involved early in this game. Moko was just 1 for 3 yesterday in 14 minutes. Using his size, his speed out there on the floor, it's going to be such a huge asset for Roosevelt today. And he really matches up well against the big man for Jefferson down low. They're going to need him to handle both Braylon Bear and Mason Payne throughout the afternoon.
Moko is a junior, 6'5", a 53% free throw shooter on the season. He gets one of two. He had just 2 points yesterday and really wasn't heavily involved. And for Roosevelt, maybe even more involved, no doubt about that. Just about an over in fact here, and here's a shot no good by Bear. Payne collects the rebound. He's gonna try to post up. They lost the handle. Loose on the floor and a basket, and Sexer will get some free throws as well. Or a free throw, I should say. And that's Goff with the foul. Check it out on the replay.
Yeah, Payne dribbled that one off his foot. He tried to recover. Luckily, his teammate there, and instead of going with the power dribble, dribbling around trying to find somebody, went straight for the hoop, found the basket, got a foul, and now the extra point. Turns into a three-point play, and you're tied up.
Sexer, their leading scorer at 12 points a game, near steal. But Roosevelt has it in the front court. Good game early on, tied at three. Ismail down the lane, throws it to the outside, no shot for Goff there. Moko steps to the outside to take a pass. Look how quick he is getting across the lane, but got bottled up by Payne. That's good defense. Five on the shot clock. Here's a drive, and that shot rolls off the rim. No good, loose on the floor, and it's collected by Roosevelt. Ismail, oh, the stop, up and under, yes, what a move.
You can see the footwork, the speed that Ismail plays with out there on the floor. He is just so smooth with that ball in his hands. His teammates, that time, doing a good job of getting right back to him. Almost had the layup, got that one on his second chance opportunity.
Bear wide open on the three, no good. Nielsen collects the rebound. Now Ismail will run the show. Guarded by Bohannon. Man to man, the Cavaliers. Garang has the shorter man on him, but gives it up to Moko. Goes across the lane, uses the window nicely. Akeem Moko. A little bit of pressure by Roosevelt, slowing it down. And here's Payne in the lane. He had it taken away by Moko. Ismail on the move. And counted in the foul. What a speedy move by Ismail. And that foul will be on Fields. Timeout on the court. We got a good one underway between the Cavaliers and the Rough Riders. Back in a moment right here on SDPB3.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Three Roosevelt early on. They're on a 6-0 run after over the last 52 seconds. I'm Steve Toome. He's J.J. Hartigan. J.J., a much better start for Roosevelt today.
Yeah, and one thing they did really well yesterday was the offensive rebounding category. Of their 27 rebounds in the loss yesterday, 14 of them were offensive. They've already picked up a couple big ones here today. Two of their four rebounds have come off the offensive glass. They're getting second chance tries. They're finding ways to score early, and again, just feeding that young man. He has been terrific. 2 of 3 from the field now with 5 points. Ishmael really has been a leader out there on the floor over the first 2 days of this tournament.
Bear on the move, gives way to Payne. He's loose on the baseline and got an angle and scores.
It's his first shot of the day, his first make of the day. And again, keeping him involved in the offense is going to be so huge for Sioux Falls Jefferson. A big part of what they do on both ends of the floor.
Pass tipped away, but it's in the hands one of the subs, and that's Bylander who gets the shot. Memphis Bylander. He and Jackson Brower, number 23, into the game for Roosevelt.
Bylander was used somewhat sparingly yesterday. Came in later towards the second half of the game, but they're trying to get him involved with his speed and his lankiness out there today to try to disrupt defensively. Pretty good shooter on the other end, too.
And there's a shot and a pull-up by Fields, and it's good. They were trying to feed it inside to the big man, Payne. He was being guarded by Tayden Nave, number 22, who's in the game. So Roosevelt, few subs on the floor. Nasser fakes the three. Gets around Fields, has it blocked. I love this matchup of Ishmael and Fields.
Yeah, just two really good guards, speedy, just attacking each other, seeing who can kind of out-duel each other with their moves out there. When you've got a big post player like Payne waiting in the wings, that can be such an asset to a guard, knowing that you've got that help defense coming your way.
And we're going to have an offensive foul, illegal screen on Roosevelt. And they're going to catch Nave, and that is his first.
Yeah, you can see Daniel Jones trying to split between those two defenders there, got tripped up. It's a very speedy player for the Sioux Falls Jefferson team, and losing his footing there was kind of a clear call right in front of the officials.
A little bit of pressure. They'll get it across the timeline, but here's the double team. And that's Unzen who's into the game. Chase Unzen, he was in a bit of trouble. Daniel Jones, number 12, into the game, along with number 24, Ed Whiting. Whiting moves in the paint, throws it to the outside. Sexer up off the window, scores. Tough shot.
Especially using your right hand there on the left side of the paint with the defender near your shooting hand. That's not an easy shot. Good selection using the glass, though, to ensure that one goes in.
A handoff to Goff. He had the big second half yesterday. Doesn't have the opening. Bylander puts it on the floor. Can't get the shot off. Now it'll turn. No good. Whiting clears away the rebound. Cavaliers on the move. Fields. Gets bottled up. Whiting loose on the baseline, but he stopped in the blocks. Here's a three on the way, in and out for Jones, and Ishmael clears the rebound.
I thought that was a pretty patient approach there from Jefferson. They found an open shooter near the top of the key. It was a high percentage look, just didn't fall for him, but a good selection from Jones.
Nave scores. One man heading off to Northern to play football. His brother Tyree played on those back-to-back championship teams.
And to have a big man who can step out and shoot the three and also be a physical defender inside, that's such an asset for this Roosevelt team.
There's Jones flying down the lane to score.
We mentioned his speed. He is one of the fastest players you'll see on the court here at this tournament.
Ishmael up and under, no, and Jones clears the rebound. Outlet to Fields. Sexer through traffic. He's going to get some free throws. That foul will be on Nave, and that will be his second. Sexer on the season, a 60% free throw shooter.
Boy, you start looking at these stat lines here as we get late in the opening quarter of play. Pretty even so far. The only difference in the game right now is three-point shooting. Roosevelt's 1 of 2. They've only taken those two selections and hit one of them. Jefferson, though, 0 for 5 today from three-point land, but 50% from the field overall. So their five shots they've taken inside the arc, they're all hitting. Everything outside hasn't gone so far. Like the fact that Jefferson is continuing to attack that rim, they're going to get more free throw opportunities out of it. And they're hanging in the game because of their aggressive style here so far today.
Ethan Swenson checking in for the Cavaliers. All right, he was the quarterback on the football team. A couple of subs in here also for Roosevelt. Putting that young man, Jamari Tiger, but loses the handle. Here we go with Sexer the other way. Bounce pass, scoring is Swenson. And we're tied up at 15 with a little over a minute to go. It's the rally here by the Cavaliers. Pass, Bylander, three, short of the mark. Jones up high.
Again, that's a good look from Bylander. Caught it in rhythm, got a good look at the rim, but that's such a hard angle from the sideline there.
Jones went strong to the bucket, and he was fouled.
Again, it kind of goes to the point, you start looking at the stats, you realize that the three-point shot isn't falling for Jefferson. Instead of trying to shoot through those issues, just get out in transition, use that speed that this team has. They've gotten fouled the last two times they've tried to get out in transition, and now gotten a couple trips to the free throw line.
Jones makes the first of two. That foul was on Jackson Brower, his first.
Boy, at this level, if you're good at free throw shooting, you're going to win a lot of basketball games. These two teams, pretty high percentage as far as team comparisons are concerned. Strong suit for both squads.
Yep, and pretty even. 62% as a team for the Cavaliers, 63% for Roosevelt. A little trouble in the backcourt. Tiger comes over to take the ball. He'll be guarded by Swenson. Mari Tiger got those bright pink tennis shoes on. Easy to spot him out there. Young man's lived in four different countries in his life already. Started playing basketball in Israel. And he's going to get tagged for the five count. Shot clock will be off as the Cavaliers will play it in, we suspect, for the final opportunity as they've rallied to take a two-point lead. They were down by six early on.
Yeah, both teams still hovering around 50%. Roosevelt right now at 46% shooting for the quarter. Jefferson, though, at 55%. They want to finish strong here.
Jones on the move. Throws it outside. Bohannon, tough shot. Got it. Tyler Bohannon. And here's a shot. It will not come close. A lot of contact. No foul. And we're done with one. 19. To 15. Cavaliers on top, back in a moment right here on SDPB3.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
At BankWest, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. BankWest.
Get a look at the Cavalier huddle as we're ready to start the second period of play. Class AA Boys Basketball Tournament. Along with J.J. Hartigan, I'm Steve Toom. That was a really good first quarter of basketball.
It really was. Jefferson ended that quarter strong. A 10-0 run to end that first quarter of play. And now with the four-point lead, it's going to be Roosevelt with the basketball as they try to reestablish a little bit of control of this game and get back into it. But again, 46% shooting, nothing to shake your head at 6 of 13. Jefferson 7 of 12, one fewer shot, one more make. That's really the difference in this game. Jefferson's got to figure out their long distance attack, though. 0-5 from 3 in that opening quarter. Roosevelt just 1 of 3 from distance. Both teams doing a good job getting to the free throw line. It's been a very solid offensive start here today for both teams.
This Mayo missed on the long distance shot. Bohannon takes it coast to coast. And he's going to tap it away after Roosevelt got the rebound and another opportunity for Jefferson.
Speed and determination, that'll win a lot of games. Jefferson's been showing that in bunches here so far today.
Fields moves against Ismail, tries the up and under, got it. He's got four. I love that matchup between those two speedsters. That will be, I think, you know, the smallest guys on the court, maybe the most exciting players to watch.
Yeah, nobody's working harder than two for both jerseys. You get two in the maroon uniforms there, two in white. They are going nose to nose. They're on each other's hips every single play. It's been a fun matchup here so far.
Now Jefferson switching up to his zone defense as Nielsen had it blocked out of bounds by Payne.
Boy, defense has kind of been the story of this tournament so far over the first four and a half games, if you will. Yeah, one guy last night for Huron, 8 blocks in one game.
Yeah, it was Elwine.
Yeah, we've already seen 2 today from Payne. What does he have in store for us as far as padding stats?
There's a steal by Fields. Oh, he got tripped up. And will he get the free throws? I believe he will.
I think they said he was trying to go up, but his legs got taken out from underneath him. And another trip to the line here for Jefferson. They're a perfect 5 for 5 at the free throw line so far today. That's exactly where they want to be heading into this matchup. Again, free throws yesterday, they were 8 of 12 as a team. Pretty good number.
And that one will fall. Fields on the year, 70%. He is a junior.
You see Tim Reck pacing the sidelines, a guy who was a longtime assistant in the Sioux Falls School District, finally getting a chance to be a head coach, and boy, he has been great. He's had a lot of success with this Jefferson team. They got third place at the state tournament last year. Came in as quite the underdog with the 8 seed to this tournament. But really, over the last 3.5 quarters now, their offense has looked exactly like they were when they were on that 6-game winning streak.
Yes, this team did qualify back in 2022, their first year of existence. And here's a 3 in and out. But there's Garang to clean it up, and he'll score. He's got 4.
Great to see that young man getting involved early in this game. Garang yesterday was just 1 for 3, did play 22 minutes, but wasn't a huge part of the offense. He's already gotten 2 big buckets for Roosevelt here in the first half.
Sexer high off the window, tipped to the outside, controlled by Ismail. He's on the move. And it'll be man-to-man for Jefferson. Goff lost the handle there. Ismail actually played at Jefferson his sophomore year and then transferred back to Roosevelt. Nielsen, that might have been partially blocked. And here comes Bohannon. 3 on the way, no. High in the lane to collect it was Nielsen. Ismail, and I think he traveled, yep. They'll bring in Jackson Brower into the lineup. Brower averages 6.5 points per game. He's a 6'4 senior. Nielsen will get a break for Roosevelt. Coming up on the 5-minute mark till halftime. Jefferson slowly comes up, and now here's the double team. Gets it away to Payne. Now Bohannon has it blocked with a foul. Brower can't believe it. And he will be tagged for the foul, and that will be his second. Timeout on the court. Got a good one here going between Jefferson and Roosevelt. Back in a moment with more on SDPB3.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other, lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Get a look at some of the fans here on a Friday afternoon. Jefferson fans there. We're in the Denny Sanford Premier Center. Along with J.J. Hardigan, I'm Steve Toon. Day 2, Class AA Boys Basketball Tournament 23-17. Jefferson on top. And J.J., Roosevelt had that cold shooting first half yesterday. They got a decent start today, but it seems like those cold shooting woes have returned.
Yeah, looking at the numbers here, it looks like the last 2 minutes of that second quarter, and now they've had kind of a dry run here. Just one make over the last 4.5 minutes. Jefferson back at the line. They're in the midst of this run. The first miss from the free throw line today for Jefferson. But Roosevelt hanging in this game. Got to find a way to figure out that offense, though.
Bohannon makes one of two. He's got 3 points. It looks like Jefferson's going to set up in a zone defense. And the pass is tipped out of bounds. It'll stay team in red.
For Roosevelt, they're trying to figure out how to break that zone right now. Get through, get some passing lanes. The zone kind of designed to take away those opportunities from the top of the key. Keep the ball outside of the paint. That's where it's been hanging for the majority of this second quarter now.
And that one's off the foot of Goff out of bounds. Matchup here between two schools. Roosevelt, they were the newcomers about 30 years ago when that school started up in the early 90s. And of course, Jefferson, I believe, third year of existence, and they have had a pretty good run in athletics so far.
Yeah, gifted with a lot of players who transferred over from other schools. Roosevelt in particular lost a lot of really talented players to this Jefferson school when it came in. But that's just kind of the way of the world when you have to fill classrooms, find space for kids. When the city keeps growing, you got to add another school, and opportunities
school districts are
there.
Yeah. Rezoned, so the map changed. And you know, Roosevelt probably the biggest school, but the other schools in Sioux Falls affected as well, as Sioux Falls growing at a very rapid rate. And now we've got four big public high schools, three of them represented here at the tournament this weekend, as Ismail misses on the three. Bear fighting for the rebound, and I think they're gonna catch Garang with the foul. That is his first. You know, and Roosevelt, you know, they came in and, you know, obviously the thing that put them on the map right away was girls basketball.
Absolutely, yeah.
Coach Tibbetts, and what a dynasty they had there. And, you know, they built up their other programs to where they're, you know, always in the mix.
Yeah, and that women's basketball program at one point had won over 100 games in a row. Like, it's just unbelievable the record runs that they went on and the stories that have been told with that team and the trips they took. But, yeah.
And that ball's out of bounds off of Jefferson off the nice block.
I think the fun kind of transition to that story is watching now the career of Nate Tibbetts and what he's doing and moving on and getting a chance to be a women's NBA coach. The son of a former Sioux Falls High School coach getting a chance to move up to the highest levels. We've seen a lot of big names from the state of South Dakota represent basketball well around the country.
Yep, Garang scores. Got to mention Becky Hammond.
Yep.
As a Hall of Fame player, great coach, and we're going to have a blocking foul on Ismail near half court. That'll be his second. And I'm hoping that Becky Hammond gets an NBA coaching job. I hope that happens sometime down the line. It would be great.
I think she'll be the first. Might see Dawn Staley from South Carolina get a chance to do it at some time too, but women's basketball is on the rise in ways that we haven't seen in a long, long time with Caitlin Clark, what she's doing in the college ranks right now. There are kids in the state of South Dakota that are growing up watching those kids grow the game of basketball, turn them into legends, and who knows, maybe some of these boys basketball players will kind of do the same thing that Mike Miller did for the state of South Dakota at one point. this Mitchell team this year has a lot of very talented players, and I think Mike Miller probably excited to see if they can't claim a state title by weekend's end.
There's Ismail with the tray. He's got 8 points. Roosevelt cutting into that lead. Cavaliers were starting to pull away from them. They turn the ball over, and now there comes the trap. Looking nicely by the Cavaliers. Fields was wide open, and he collects a three-pointer.
There's that shot that's been missing for Jefferson all day long, really all tournament. The three-point shooting just hasn't been there. They were 31% from distance yesterday, struggled throughout much of that first half. 2 of 9 here today. They're hanging tough in this game. They've built this lead up to 8 now. Haven't needed that three nearly as much as they would have in that first round matchup.
Here's Moko down the lane and rolls off the rim. He's fighting for his own rebound, and I think they're gonna tag Whiting for a foul here for the Cavaliers. And they will, and that will be his first.
And it was on the way down with the rebound, so it was not in the act of shooting. Roosevelt will inbound this one here on the baseline, but Moko has been much more involved today. So has Garang in the offense, utilizing their speed, their skill set, their size. Roosevelt needs that interior presence today.
Whiting got another quick foul, his second, as they tried the alley-oop to Moko, who elevated at 6'5". 3 seniors, 2 juniors in the starting lineup for Roosevelt. That one will not fall. Their main bench players, Johnson a senior, Bylander a sophomore, Knave is a senior, Brower is a senior, Tiger is a junior, so a lot of experience out there for Roosevelt in their main players. That one no good, and Whiting clears the rebound.
And again, the post players for Roosevelt needing to step up today. Moko and Garang combined for just 5 points yesterday in the loss. They've done a good job getting involved here so far today. 9 points between the two of them.
There's Sexer down the lane with the Euro step, and he got the bucket. He's got 9. This male calling out the play. He sends it over to Garang. Man to man for the Cavaliers. Mail wants the screen, doesn't get it. Pulls up, no. Tipped around, no. Fields collects the rebound. He's looking up court, lobs it ahead. Jones, bounce pass. Unzen too strong, and there's Goff collecting a rebound. Goff is gonna pull up for 3, no. Oh, Bylander tried to come in from the weak side, but it kind of hung up in the air, and he flew right by. Jones muscles his way to the basket and scores. He's got 6.
So quick off that first dribble. He had a step on the defender before he really even got the ball to the hardwood. Just such a smooth move from the top of the key down to the hoop. Jones has had a good start here in the first 2 quarters.
Believe it or not, it's a 12-point lead for the Cavaliers. Here's a 3. Good. First points for Goff as the Nets get held up. The shot clock will be off as a sub comes in for Roosevelt. That's Elijah Johnson. And Ismail getting a rare break. Elijah Johnson, his brother Micah was on the 2022 championship team. And Elijah wants to get into the real estate business after graduation.
Plenty of opportunity for that here in Sioux Falls.
Yeah, wait, this town's growing. Coming up on the 10-second mark. Cavaliers soon playing for the final opportunity, but they're gonna launch a 3. That's no good. And we're gonna have Fields with the foul, and that will be his second. That'll be the third team foul, so that really doesn't hurt. Send Roosevelt to the free throw line. 4.2 seconds left. Rough Riders have the entire length of the court to go. Bohannon in, Fields out with the final few seconds. Johnson launches, no, from half court. 34-25, good first half for the Cavaliers. We'll be back with our halftime highlights and stats after this break on SDPB3.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Coverage of the South Dakota High School Activities Association event is made possible by a partnership between the SDHSAA and SDPB. Sponsors of SDPB's coverage include Dakota Bank, South Dakota Corn, and by Lloyd Companies, Bank West, South Dakota State University, the South Dakota Department of Education, and by your membership in the Friends of SDPB.
We are back at halftime of our first consolation game of the afternoon, and Jefferson out to a 9-point lead on Roosevelt. Roosevelt led 9-3 to start this game off in the first quarter. The Cavaliers kind of found their footing from there, and Roosevelt kind of going into a little bit of a scoring slump. As we check out some of the first half highlights, good interior play by Roosevelt.
Yeah, this was actually a really good start for both teams. Roosevelt hit a little mini skid there midway through the first quarter and allowed Jefferson to get back in it, and then that skid continued into quarter number two. Damaris Fields and what the offense has brought from his side of things over the first 2 days has been really nice for Jefferson. Payne continues to make his mark in this game. You're starting to see some of the other guys for Roosevelt getting involved. Remember, it was Ishmael yesterday, pretty much had all the points for Roosevelt in the first half. Much more balanced attack today, but you're really getting a balanced attack from Jefferson as well. Inside, outside, they're starting to hit from all angles right now. The three finally started falling after an 0-for-8 start to the day for Jefferson. They've got a couple in the first half. And in all, not a bad shooting half for either team. Roosevelt saw it dip below 40% right at the end of the half there, now at 38% on the day. But to Jefferson, right at 50% even from the field, still just 2 of 10 from three-point land. They'd like to see that number improve, but going 8 of 9 at the free throw line, they'll take that any day of the week.
Jefferson outscored Roosevelt 15 to 10 in that second period of play, and that's why they're up 9 here at halftime. Fields and Sexer with 9 each to lead the way for the Cavaliers. And it's 8 points for Nasser Ismail leading the way for the Rough Riders. We'll be back with more after this timeout on SDPB3.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
At Bank West, our relationships are everything. They reach beyond banking. We're committed to understanding your vision and upholding your values as partners in your success. Building a future filled with opportunity. Bank West.
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther. Going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, We keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring. Keep making memories. Keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry, anthemoats.com.
First Dakota is here for the shared community experiences, the competition, long-standing rivalries, the players and coaches, seeing friends again, and cheering on our favorite teams. It's what makes life great here, and First Dakota is here for it.
Jefferson ahead of Roosevelt here at halftime. You know, if you've spent some time in high school gyms in South Dakota, odds are you've seen some of the artwork of Dave Fuller of Parker.
You know, a lot of artists have their paintings hang in galleries, you know, and I think probably my artwork in all the gyms around, you know, the state, people see more of my artwork than anybody because, you know, thousands will come to games and watch it.
For Dave Fuller, art's always been something he's loved.
My mom and dad were kind of instrumental. They encouraged me to do it, and they'd buy me books, and back then we didn't have YouTube and all that, so that's kind of how you learned. And I like to be able to look at a picture and be able to draw it and actually recognize who it is. And an older student or a teammate of mine did a little bit of drawing, and I thought that was pretty cool, so that's kind of how I got started. And, you know, I just like making stuff. I consider myself a maker, you know, and I like to draw and paint and, you know, but I'm trying to learn all different types of art.
You're right, Fuller. You're always right.
And so has the game of basketball.
I started out as a basketball coach under legendary Coach Gail Hoover. And before that, I played for Burnell Glanzer at Armour. And I played for Dakota Wesleyan under Gordy Fawcett. So, I mean, I have three coaches that were legends, you know, that I got to play for or coach with.
And after many years of manning the sidelines for the Parker Pheasants, he's found a new way to combine both of his passions.
The first funeral I ever did was in Parker. And, you know, I didn't have a summer job. And our athletic booster president, Roger Connect, he said, well, why don't you paint a mural in the gym? And so my first painting is Parker, and I just did a quick watercolor sketch on watercolor paper. Back then, I don't even know if we had computers and all that, but and they liked it, and it's still up here. But yeah, Parker was my first one, and it kind of, when people saw that, that's, you know, word of mouth, that's kind of how I got some of the other jobs, so.
And starting wasn't easy.
You know, I had to learn pretty much on my own how to get the drawing up on the wall and, you know, what kind of paints do I have to use. I think my artistic ability, I knew how to paint it after it was all up there, but it's kind of a work in progress. I try to push myself harder and harder to do more difficult things, you know. I think mine have a lot more detail.
And over the years, he's developed his own style.
I talked to schools, I'd probably give them anywhere from 10 to 12 different designs, and it seems to me that they like the murals with the mascot breaking through the wall. But I also like painting some Harrisburg Tigers, you know, where you just see the eyes coming through the wall, stuff like that. And I kind of have hopefully my own style that you can tell that I've done that one compared to maybe a student or another artist. I try to paint a lot of realism ones too, but then also do some caricatures, try to mix it up. But a lot of times they like the fierce mascot breaking through the wall and bricks flying out, and so they like those a lot.
And Fuller doesn't mind being recognized as South Dakota's mural man.
You know, it's fun for me to do and fun for me to look back and see how many ones I've done. it's kind of nice to be recognized for that. I'd rather be recognized for being, you know, Hall of Fame coach or something like that, but that's a pretty neat second.
SDPB is committed to telling great stories that surround high school sports and activities in South Dakota on a yearly basis. To check out more of our video features, go to sdpb.org/basketball. Getting ready for the start of the second half here between the Rough Riders and the Cavaliers. Along with J.J. Hartigan, I'm Steve Toon. Great to have you here on a Friday afternoon. Great weather in the area. A little cloudy, sun came out, and most importantly, no snow in the forecast here on the eastern side of the state.
Yeah, we might get a little windy tomorrow, but you know what? If it's 45, 50 degrees with a little wind in March during state tournament time, we'll take it. I can remember blizzards and all kinds of nasty weather this time of year. We'll take whatever we got going on outside right now, but really happy to be inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center. We've had three, four really good basketball games already through the first five that we've seen, and expect this to continue to be a nice shooting effort from Jefferson. Roosevelt still trying to figure out those offensive numbers, but they look like a much improved basketball team from what we saw 24 hours ago.
Offensive rebound by Bear, and that's tapped away and stolen by Goff.
Really, it just seems like both teams have settled into the state tournament vibe right now. Steve, yesterday, maybe playing a little bit faster than they normally would, trying to catch up to the pace of the game and all the elements that go on at being at the state tournament, the pomp and circumstance. And that can take a toll on a team on day one. But settling in now, it seems like both teams have kind of found their identity again out there on the floor.
And that'll be a foul on Braylon Bear, his first. Remember, he was in foul trouble, had to ride the pine a lot yesterday as Nielsen gets to the line and he misses his first free throw, yet to score in the game. Senior, a 59% free throw shooter on the season. Averages a little over 4 points and 2.5 rebounds per game.
Nobody in double figures in this game as of yet, although Jefferson has two players with 9 points today. The foul gets called here.
Yep, I think it was Nielsen going after the missed free throw as he goes 0 for 2 at the line.
Fields and Sexer both with 9 points for Jefferson so far. 8 points on the other side for Roosevelt's Ishmael. 6 points for Garang. You're getting some individual contributions that look good. Really team efforts, though, from both teams here so far today.
Fields quickly to the bucket. A little too strong off the window. Moco clears the rebound. Ishmael on the move. Back to Moco. They play catch. Try a little give and go, and there's Moco with the rebound. Missed the stick back, and Bohannon clears it away for Jefferson. A couple of good opportunities there for Roosevelt. Go by the wayside. Man, it's got to be heartbreaking for Roosevelt. They had a couple good looks. Sexer. Oh, I think they hit the bottom of the backboard, but it was blocked, and the ball will stay with the Cavaliers.
First 90 seconds into this second half, neither team has hit from the field yet. Jefferson 0 for 2 from the field since halftime. Roosevelt 0 for 3.
Offensive foul. Sexer put his shoulder into the man. You can tell he's a football player.
Yep, yep. And that's, again, you have to kind of try to toe that line of being a physical player out there on the floor, but being smart about how you go about it. And that time maybe just leaning a little too far in. A lot of times you can create separation if you use your body weight, things like that out there on the floor to try to just get the defender off balance. Lean a little too hard, those officials will be right on top of it.
Swing it around. Ishmael with the drive. Oh, so quick.
Wouldn't be surprised if he's a good dancer. He's got that nifty footwork out there. He's so good at working in tight spaces. One of those guys who can just go out and kind of with his feet glide across the floor and find a way to get to the hoop.
Here comes the double team. They'll get it away to Bear. Now swing it over to Bohannon. Gets a step on Goff, and he'll get some free throws. Good move there by Tyler Bohannon. Draws the second personal foul on Hayden Goff. Bohannon, he's a senior, averages a little over 8.5 points and 2 rebounds per game. He's 1 of 2 at the line of today, 55% on the year.
10 points yesterday, now 7 after that free throw make here today. Pretty much playing around his average. He'd like to see that go up a little bit, though, before the tournament ends, but it was 50% from the field yesterday. 1 of 3 from three-point land.
More importantly, he's been hitting his free throws all tournament. He was 3 of 4 at the line yesterday. Looks good here so far today, now going 3 of 4. Good solid day for Bohannon, and really just a good tournament all around as far as his numbers are concerned.
Yep, good all-around athlete. He is a high jump specialist on the track team for the Cavaliers. Pull up Jay, short, rebound Bohannon. Here's a 3-on-2. Bohannon feeds Sexer, finishes with the left hand, very nicely done. 11 for Dawson Sexer.
First Cavalier into double figures today.
Ismail pulls up, no. Rebound fought for, who's got it? Tipped away out of bounds by Garang as Bear came up with it. And shooting woes kind of continuing for Roosevelt. They'll go to the bench and get Kamari Thomas. First appearance in the tournament for the 5'10 senior. Where's number 10? Sexer, they'll get it across timeline with Payne. Couple dribbles for him. Sexer, boy, he loves to initiate contact, up and under, no. And we're gonna have a foul, and that I believe is gonna be on Dawson Sexer on the rebound. As we're at 4:50 left to go, and we will have a timeout on the court. Yep, Sexer does get that second foul. Jefferson up by 11, back in 1 minute on SDPB3.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour. You know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal. All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
Oh, my goodness.
Tim Reck, middle of that huddle there for the Cavaliers. His team up by 11, third quarter. On SDPB3, this is the boys AA basketball tournament. Along with JJ Hartigan, I'm Steve Toome. Roosevelt will have the ball coming out of the timeout, and Roosevelt just can't seem to close that distance. It seems like every time they get a bucket or two, Jefferson has a counter.
Yeah, really, it's been a very nice run here for this Sioux Falls Jefferson team, really since midway through that first quarter. They found their offensive rhythm. They've been putting up big points since then. Roosevelt had the early advantage today offensively, but just kind of lost that shooter's touch. Still trying to find it here. That was another spot-on good look. Had an open look, just didn't quite have enough muscle behind it to get it all the way through.
That was Goff on the miss there. Bear got that rebound, and now let's see what Jefferson does on offense. As Bohannon can't get it to fall, as he danced around the defender. He'll get two free throws, and that will be on Nasser Ismail. Now that's his third foul. A lot of time left here in this third quarter. And we'll see a sub come to the scorer's table as Bohannon's free throw is good. A couple of subs in. It's going to be Moko and Garang going to the bench. Interior players coming in. Carson Hoynes, number 21. Jackson Brower, 23. Got them both. He's got 10. And here comes a trap. And a pile up on the floor. They're going to call over and back. Tough spot there for number 10, Kamari Thomas, kind of in no man's land. And Coach Begeman wants an explanation on that one. Fields, hands off to Bohannon, circles around. Now Sexer comes the other way. Here's the open shooter, it's Bear, yes! His first points of the afternoon, and that is a huge tray. because it moves the Cavaliers up by 16.
Just 2 points yesterday. He was in foul trouble throughout much of it. Good to see him getting some offensive looks here today.
Fields almost got a steal, and here's a jumper that's short by Hoynes. Rebound, Bohannon. When you have a guard like Bohannon that can just jump out of the building, you have him on the backside of that zone defense, go in there and get some rebounds. That's a big plus for any team.
Now this Jefferson lineup is really solid. They've got size at the right places. They've got athletes all over the floor.
There's a pile up for the ball. We'll have a jump ball. Possession arrow favors Roosevelt. Thomas lead the team forward, run the offense, and move Ismail over to the shooting guard position.
It's been 3 minutes now since Roosevelt last put a point on the board. It's a 9-0 run over the last 250 for Jefferson.
Here's Fields with the run out and the layup. Damaris Fields with 11. This game's starting to get away from Roosevelt.
Three players now for Jefferson in double figures. You mentioned Fields with his 11. Sexer also has 11. Bohannon now has 10. Seeing the three big scorers for this Jefferson team really shine here today.
And another turnover as Ismail lost the handle. Here come the Cavaliers yet again. They are in full control of this game. See what offense they run. Another post up Payne, works against Hoynes, got it with the left hand. 4 points for him. And a timeout has been called by Coach Begeman. His team is kind of struggling at the moment. And it's hard to imagine, they're down by 20 points. Remember, these two teams played close games during the regular season, both won by the Cavaliers. 51-48, 58-56, those were the final scores. But this one, a completely different affair.
Yeah, really, I mean, Roosevelt came out and scored the first 2 points of this third quarter, but now it's been a 13-0 run for Sioux Falls Jefferson over the last 3 minutes and 40 seconds. Just dominance here in this third quarter.
In Play with Craig Maddock features in-depth discussions about all things sports in South Dakota. Through these conversations, we learn about the players, the programs, and the legends who help shape the current sports landscape of the Mount Rushmore State. You can find the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, and wherever you get your podcasts. And be sure to leave us a 5-star review so that others are able to find it. That is In Play with Craig Maddock. Louis Croakman, one of the recent subjects. I remember watching him play for White River and then at USD. What a player.
He put on a show anytime he stepped on the hardwood. Louis is one of the legends of South Dakota basketball. If you go to certain coffee shops, they'll sit and tell you all these stories about the amazing nights he had in their gym and other towns across the state of South Dakota. When he got down to the U and he was playing inside the Dakota Dome, man, that was special.
It was. And now he's in the White River School District. I believe is it principal or superintendent?
Yeah,
one of those two positions,
I know. He's in an administrative role, and it's a great place for him to be because he gets to impact a lot of young men and women who are looking to be athletes and just, again, as students as well. It's a guy that you want to have around your students as they grow and mature.
One of the nicest guys you'll meet, and I remember when he was playing for USD, they're playing state, and they tried to get an anti-Louis chant going, but it just didn't have any steam because you just can't root against the guy.
Okay, yeah.
No way, that's right. There's a rebound off the miss by Unzen, and there's taken away by Sexer. One man to beat, that's Goff, and we're going to have an offensive foul.
Sexer, last couple possessions that he's had the ball in his hand, maybe getting a little bit too aggressive on the offensive side. You love to see that attack. You love to see the urge to get to the hoop, but you lower the shoulder like that and you start bulldozing the defenders. The officials are going to see it. Now that's two or three times, I think, in this second half alone that they've gotten him tagged with it, or he could have picked up a foul along the way.
And Sexer's going to get a foul.
And the officials are even saying now, like, let's settle down just a little bit. A lot of these guys, multi-sport athletes, play football. They know each other well. They've played a ton of games whether it be AAU, high school basketball, just working out during the summer.
Playing these baseball guys, against each other in the summertime. Yeah, these guys, you know, they'll play on different teams. They'll play, you know, they may play on the same baseball team, but at a different high school. So you just don't know. There's all these other activities around town. And, you know, sometimes what, you know, familiarity breeds contempt sometimes, but...
Now, if you talk to some of the old hats around the gym today, guys who played ball in the late 90s, early 2000s, that kind of play was kind of commonplace, getting real physical in your face. It's kind of gotten away from that style over the last few years. Players have had to adjust, but there's just some dudes. Begeman, if you remember watching him play, Mitch Begeman, when he was an athlete, some of the most aggressive players that we've seen were guys that played with him, against him during that time period. It's just a style that maybe isn't around nearly as much. And so acclimating yourself to the rules of the game today, staying within those rules, it's not always easy for some of these real competitive athletes out there, but these officials do a great job of maintaining that order out there on the court.
Goff with the foul as they were trying to go for a trap on Bohannon in the corner. And the style of play has changed over the year, much more perimeter game. Yep. You know, the three-point shot, the shot clock has certainly changed things. And just the way they play in the NBA and major college, you know, it's much more perimeter game. Although, when you got a good big man and a good guard, that's still a potent combination. Jones almost lost it, puts it up and in.
You know, one big man that I remember from my high school playing days, I didn't really play, I watched him play, but Anthony Cordova played for this Roosevelt team. He was here yesterday, actually. Played ball up at South Dakota State during his college days. Very physical, forward, post-type player. Guy who could get in. And I know his son's playing over at Lincoln, and they're thinking he's going to be big time over there in a couple of years now as well. But there's a lot of those guys that still preach that type of grittiness in the interior, and there's a few players. We've seen Payne and a couple of these big post players in this tournament who have enforced their will at times.
There's a big
games.
Block.
Yeah.
Right there, would you have a ball kick? Yes, we do. Who's it going to? I think it's going to go to Roosevelt. And the thing is, and you and I have called a lot of college games over the years, it's still physical at the college level, and if you're going to be a stand-on high school player thinking of the next level, you have to get used to that physicality. You see, you know, at Division II, NAIA, D1, it's a much more physical game, both men's and women's basketball.
Yep.
And so, you know, when you got a good player, you know, you know, the coaches are going to challenge them to be, hey, be physical, because if you're going to the next level, it's going to happen.
Well, one player I think of right now that's playing college basketball, a former South Dakota high school star, and Kalen Gary, what he's doing at South Dakota State. He's a very physical player, a gritty defensive player. And if kids around the state of South Dakota want to watch what it takes to get to that next level, he wasn't on anybody's radar going into his senior season, but he showed up at some tournaments in December of his senior year, and all of a sudden, these college coaches said, oh my goodness, we could use this guy at the next level. It's that hard work, the dedication that you put in year in and year out in the gym when nobody else is watching, that's when it starts to show up.
Garang gets the foul, and that is his second, as Jones was driving towards the bucket. Jones has had a very good afternoon for the Cavaliers. He's got 9 points. Sometimes you find that diamond in the rough. I think the by days, Stacy Finkbeiner, one of the all-time greats at Black Hill State, wasn't heavily recruited, became an All-American and one of the school's all-time top scorers. He was came out of Belle Fouche as Jones hit that second free throw. Not on too many people's radars, and Yellow Jackets got a gem there.
That's been a fun program to watch the last few years, too.
Yep. A few seconds left here. Ismail working against Fields. He'll have to put it in motion. A little jump step. No. Payne, the rebound. Cannot collect it. He did maybe take a step there, but time ran out on the quarter. Big lead. The Cavaliers in control, up by 20 points. Back in a moment with the fourth quarter on SDPB3.
What does primary care mean to us? At Sanford Health, it means being there when and where you need it most. It means building a relationship, because when a provider really knows you, they can deliver the best care for every aspect of your health and your life. So what does primary care mean for you? It means understanding your health for today and for where you're headed next. It means a lifetime of care for a lifetime of you.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small. just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
A bad quarter for Roosevelt, a good quarter for Jefferson in that third quarter. Jefferson outscoring the Rough Riders 17-6, and they've opened up a 20-point lead here in consolation play at the AA Boys Basketball Tournament in Sioux Falls, along with J.J. Hardigan. I'm Steve Toon. Glad to have you here on a Friday afternoon.
Yeah, it's been a 32-16 run for Sioux Falls Jefferson since the start of the second quarter. Just dominance on the offensive side. They've done a great job. Getting a look here right now around the Denny Sanford Premier Center, the great looks that we've been getting here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. That's because of some of the volunteers who've been helping us out. Student camera operators, you know, Gorman, Jefferson, Roosevelt, all stepping up to help make our broadcast great throughout this tournament. We want to give them credit where credit is due. They've been bringing us all the sights and sounds here over the first day and a half of this three-day event here in Sioux Falls.
You bet. Thank you to our camera people and to our entire production and engineering crew, as that shot was missed down on the other end by the Cavaliers. Tiger with the drive, shut off there by Unzen. Bylander up and in. He's got four. His first point since quarter number one. Soft pressure here by Roosevelt. Unzen manages to get to the corner, but no shot. And he'll run the show now along with Fields.
Well, you don't want this to go into coast mode, right? You don't want Jefferson just to kind of say, all right, we've got this in the bag. We're just gonna wait out the final 8 minutes and see how it goes. Staying aggressive, staying physical, and staying within yourself. And there you can see Coach Rex saying, hey, let's get back to our style of play here a little bit.
And for Roosevelt, it's just, hey, we got to chop down the tree one swing at a time. Just cut into the lead. Good, solid possessions on offense and play tough defense.
Got some athletes out here on the floor for Roosevelt. And see, though, trying to get into that rhythm that they were in throughout much of the season. It's just been a struggle here over the first day and a half. Even those inbound passes, trying to find an open shooter down low, just hasn't come easy.
Bohannon into the front court. Roosevelt 33% from the floor. Cavaliers at 49%. Trying to post up Payne, and here's Bohannon with the step. Duran clears the rebound. Ismail on the move. And I think he's going to be fouled, blocking foul. Two free throws coming up.
Ismail today is taking a lot of shots again. 14 throughout the day, 10 points. Now Tim Reck wants to take a timeout and talk things over. You look at some of the production from these players from Roosevelt, though, they are getting some guys to step up today and have better days than they had yesterday. Garang, 3 of 5 today, 6 points in this contest. He's added in 3 rebounds and an assist in 19 minutes. He's been playing out there without really foul trouble. He's picked up 2 now, but he's been out of foul trouble today. That's a nice sign. And you get other guys contributing as well. Nate, perfect 2 for 2 from the field, including hitting a big 3 in that one. They've got shooters on that offensive side for Roosevelt. Now just trying to find that consistency as a full team and get everyone involved. They've got a deep bench. They use more players in this tournament than anybody else in the 8-team field heading into today's action. They really dump as many players out of that bench as they can to try to keep everybody healthy, everybody strong on the court. Just haven't had some shots fall. Goff, 1 of 6 today. 5 of those shots have come from 3-point land. They're trying to find rhythm for Bylander again. He's taken some deep shots that haven't fallen. When they do fall, this is a very good offense. It's just Roosevelt's hit one of those tough offensive skids you never want to have happen here in the month of March, and unfortunately they're fighting through it right now.
Yeah, Roosevelt, a 41% team from beyond the arc, but that has not happened in either game so far. Didn't happen yesterday, and so far, those 3-point shots eluding him. Unzen breaks the press, throws across court to Jones, but he'll back it out. And the Cavaliers will set up the offense. Try to burn a little clock here. Jones will fire, misses on the 3, and Duran collects the rebound. is Mail working against Bohannon. Garang will set up a three, too strong. Bohannon a rebound. Jefferson can afford to be deliberate here, so back it out. Clock is their friend at the moment with this big lead.
And it does look like they're trying to make a concerned effort here to run the offense, take as much time off as they can. They don't need to be in a rush to get points at this time. So work it inside.
Payne's got the mismatch, and he scores as he stepped around Garang.
He's played good minutes today, approaching 20 minutes in this game for the big man. He's only got 6 points, but it's as efficient as you can get. 3 of 3 from the field. They utilized him well when they needed him offensively.
Rang with the nice fake, pull up Jay, in and out. Bear collects the rebound.
Oh, and that's just tough. Rang's had back-to-back open looks that looked like they were gonna go in, hit rim, and the rim has just been unkind today. Just hasn't been able to get that to go for Roosevelt. Kind of in a nutshell how their whole tournament has gone.
Coach Tim Rex telling his guards, hey, back it out, let's start going. And here's Jones off the window. Yes, boy, he can elevate.
Double figures for Jones. Now 4 different Jefferson players have gotten into double digits scoring-wise.
Boy, Roosevelt's had trouble hanging on the ball the last few possessions on drives. Bylander puts up a shot. It might have been partially blocked. He's looking for a foul, none forthcoming. And now Jefferson will take their time, bringing the ball up the court. Bear steps outside to take a pass. He's got a mismatch, a shorter player on him. Let's see if he'll post up. Now he will. See, they'll circle around to the other side, but it's a three in and out. And the ball tipped out of bounds. Who's it belong to? Cavaliers. Timeout on the court, 4:08 left. Jefferson still in control. Back in a minute on SDPB3.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
Some of the fans inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center in Sioux Falls. We're on a Friday afternoon class, AA boys basketball, consolation action, and it has been all Jefferson. This was a 4-point game after quarter number one in favor of the Cavaliers. Cavaliers have just been consistent, playing good basketball, and for Roosevelt, shooting woes have kind of gotten worse and worse as the game has gone on.
Yeah, Jefferson's still right around 50% scoring for the day. That will help their scoring numbers go up. But going into that possession, 46% from the field, still 21% from three. They'd like to see that number grow a little bit before the end of this one. The defense has been spot on here today for Jefferson. They've played well on both ends of the floor.
Yep, Bear hit that three the last time down. Goff misses a shot. Payne cleared the rebound. And now Fields hands off to Bohannon. And he's going to be bumped as he made his way down the outside of the lane. And for Goff, Aiden Goff, that is foul number 4 for him, the 6-foot senior. Bear gets loose, and he is going to be fouled. And he'll get some free throws.
Usually not good when you hear Bear on the loose. But he's been a fun player to watch when he's been out there on the floor. 2 of 5 shooting today. Again, got into foul trouble yesterday, but has done a great job avoiding that today. Just 1 foul in 20 minutes. His first trip to the free throw line helps add to his point total today. But this has been, Steve, about as balanced an offensive attack as we've seen from Jefferson this season. 4 players in double figures. Bear and Payne each have 6. You're getting contributions up and down this starting lineup and even into their bench a little bit here today.
St. Jones with 12 points so far coming off the bench. It's been a huge boost. Ismail had the big man in the air but couldn't get around him. Now there's the switch. As Ismail working against Fields, he lost the handle and it's out of bounds. And maybe a little fatigue setting in. Ismail works so hard.
Yeah, he's played 26 minutes today. More than anybody on the court for either team. Just out there working, trying to find any way to get his team a competitive advantage. He's put up a lot of shots along the way as well. 14 attempts today for Ismail. He's got 12 points to lead all Roosevelt scorers. In fact, leads all scorers in this game.
Goff had the ball tapped away from behind by Bohannon. And it will be Thomas to trigger it in. Tiger for three. No, his shooting woes continue. Sexer up court with the rebound. 3 minutes to go in this one. Did not think we would have a 25-point difference in this game for either squad, considering how close the ball games were in the regular season.
Jefferson has just had Roosevelt's number this year. As you mentioned in our pregame show, Jefferson with wins in both of those matchups earlier in the year. It just seems like, for whatever reason, this matchup has been nice for these Cavaliers here over three games.
Yep. 2:45 and counting. And Jefferson in control. We'll see when they start clearing out the bench, one would suspect. Goff, nice little move through the paint, and it just rolls off the rim.
Just been that kind of tournament for Roosevelt.
Fields on the move, gives way to Bohannon, and a timeout called by the Cavaliers. They'll spend a full timeout here. And I want to tell you about how you can follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Well, you can. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And be sure to check out all the action and award photos by searching SDPB on Flickr. Tell us where you're watching from and read some of our great stories and watch some of our videos that feature teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. At SDPB Sports, hashtag SDHoops24. I know there's some people down in Mesa, Arizona watching us. Got an email last night. Hi, Mom.
Hi, Mom.
But I know there's people all over the country watching. We got, of course, for the schools, family, and friends across the country. And, of course, a big hello to all the men and women serving our country overseas in the military. We hope this is a nice slice of home for you here, the state basketball tournaments. Three of them all this weekend. SDPB 1, they've got the B tournament. SDPB 2, they've got the A tournament out in Rapid City. And we are here in Sioux Falls. Class AA on SDPB 3.
Yeah, things pretty much went chalk throughout the day yesterday across the state of South Dakota. Howard got the win in the 5-4 matchup, the 5 with an upset there. That from the B tournament. Class A tournament pretty much went chalk, although they did have Rapid City Christian get a win over Sioux Valley at the A tournament there in Dakota Valley, a 5-4 win over Pine Ridge. But nothing as far as major upsets on day one. We expect the night sessions from all three tournament sites to be much more competitive here this evening.
Colby Nutbrock with a big lead block. The 6'2 freshman swatted that one away.
You're seeing players who are stepping up saying, all right, this is my first taste of state tournament basketball. Who knows if I'll get back here. Going to have to come off the bench and show out a little bit now here down the stretch.
Goff hits a tray. Long pass up court. We'll try to catch some of these reserve players. Dang Quick with the ball momentarily. Handing back to Jordan Dettler. He's on the move. There's Nutbrock with the ball. Number 20 is DeAndre Garrity. The two brothers out there are 5-23, and there's a three on the way by Dang Quick, and that misses. 23 is Quick. That is his name. We double-checked on that. There's a three on the way by Tiger. No good. The long rebound will head out of bounds.
And there are several groups of brothers that are playing at this tournament here throughout the weekend. We've seen it on the girls' side as well. You get siblings that get chances to play with each other. It's rare to have these moments where you can compete at the highest levels in your state, get to do it with family members. Pretty special when you get a chance to get out there on the floor together.
Garrity with the ball, fires a three, and that's going to be an air ball. Be collected by Thomas. Minute to go. Carrying the ball, turnover, Roosevelt. Roosevelt from the floor, 29%, 44% for the Cavaliers. We'll go over all the stats after this game wraps up. And a little trouble in the backcourt there for Dettler. Throws in the middle of the court. Tiger has the steal. Now Thomas, but he missed it. Stick back, no! Rebound to the Cavaliers. And there, in a couple of seconds, kind of tells you everything you need to know about how things have gone for Roosevelt today. Just nothing falling for him. Three on the way, no good by Dettler.
I do respect the heart and the hustle that this Roosevelt team continues to play with. Not one player has hung their head throughout their struggles throughout the 2 days of this tournament. This is a very good basketball team that's just gone through some offensive struggles and get the last 18 seconds here to work out the clock. But still one day, one more game to fight and compete. This Roosevelt team will come back refreshed tomorrow and look to erase the offensive struggles they found over the first couple days.
Some of Kamari's friends are telling him to shoot it here, but orders from Coach Begeman just dribble the clock out. 60-36, Jefferson with a convincing win in the consolation bracket over Roosevelt. We'll take a timeout, come back and have highlights and stats in a moment right here on SDPB3.
We hope you're a fan of stories about heroes, because we'd like you to meet a few of ours. These folks keep our communities moving forward. They're dedicated to being here for you, navigating change, keeping you secure, and offering a helping hand to those who need it. Heroes come from many walks. Ours are here to walk with you. Go with trust. Go with people. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is as I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
I was looking for something that was gonna be close to home.
Southeast Tech has definitely helped me. I'm actually doing something that I enjoy.
This is the right place to be.
Get your degree, get to work at Southeast Tech.
This is the PBS app. It's ready for you whenever you want full episodes of your favorites, perhaps a little history, or the real story, shows with heart, or the latest news and docs. Even stream your local station live. It's all there waiting for you. So download the PBS app now for everything you love and a whole lot more to explore. Stream anytime, anywhere with the PBS app.
A convincing win for Jefferson over Roosevelt. And I got to admit, J.J. Hartigan, I did not see that coming. If you would have told me one of these teams was going to win by over 25 points, considering the close matchups, I would have said you're crazy. But strange things happen in a state basketball tournament as Jefferson beats Roosevelt today 60-38.
Yeah, and give credit where credit's due to this Jefferson team. They came out with a new kind of enthusiastic approach to the game today after their struggles yesterday. Found a way to get their rhythm going. Ishmael was so consistent for his team today again. Getting into double figures for a second straight day, but the shots just were falling for Jefferson. They made the most out of their turnovers. Transition points were there for him. Jones was able to really get up and show his athleticism today with what he did on both ends of the floor. A couple big buckets that helped push this lead out to double digits, and they never really looked back after that. Still, you're seeing the defense on the other end for Jefferson and what that contributed to the win today. The three-point struggles have been there for Jefferson now over the last 2 days. It has not been easy for them, but they figured it out on the offensive side and did a great job of getting to the free throw line 6 more times than their opponent today, and that turned in to really 10 more free throw makes than Roosevelt had throughout the course of this one. A very nice shooting effort, just south of 50% today for Jefferson. Roosevelt, you mentioned their struggles on the other side. They did a good job attacking the glass. They did a good job of forcing turnovers in this game. Actually won the rebounding battle against Jefferson, but Roosevelt, those shooting numbers, just you get 14 makes and 51 tries, it's going to be really hard to climb up that hill unless you've got a real low scoring affair. And Jefferson was hitting their buckets today. Made for a tough one here for Roosevelt.
Roosevelt only scored 13 points in the second half of this game. We'll come back with more from the AA Boys Basketball Tournament after this timeout on SDPB3.
Our teams are committed to improving quality of life in our communities. Whether we're planning construction concepts, building a new downtown development, bringing new businesses to our communities, or maintaining your apartment home. We believe everyone deserves a well-built and well-managed place to live and work. This is Lloyd.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Oh my goodness.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
We're in between games here at the AA Boys Basketball Tournament here at the Sanford Premier Center in Sioux Falls. I want to tell you about the Mobridge City Auditorium. The Sherhow Event Center was built as a WPA project back in the 1930s. It is home to 10 early murals from renowned Native American artist Oscar Howe. Additionally, the venue is also named after Bill and Jim Scher, who were Olympic medalists in wrestling. Both brothers are also in the South Dakota Sports Hall of Fame. The building has been on the National Historic Registry since 1986.
It's got a life of its own, you know. It's you don't even have to know what the history, you know, a stranger can walk in here on vacation from Connecticut and they can be in here and just be in awe of everything that it shows. And it does. It's history on these walls. You know, everything in here is priceless.
From its classic look to its historical murals, the Sherhow Arena in Mobridge is one of the more iconic sports venues in the state. The Sherhow Arena and Auditorium was built in the 1930s as part of a Works Progress Administration project. Now, more than 8 decades later, the reputation and magnitude of the building still exists.
It was a hallowed hall of sports. But I think to someone that doesn't know the place, the first thing they're gonna see is these beautiful, all these murals on the wall, and they're gonna wanna know the history of that. And so you know, it goes in two directions what it has. So if I was making the description, it might be kind of hard, because the most important things to me and to most people are the things that happened when I was 16, 17, 18 years old that happened to me in here. And that was with me and my fellow sports fans and fellow athletes.
The priceless murals on the wall were painted by legendary Native American painter Oscar Howe in 1942, prior to his service in the Second World War.
I think that, the artist Oscar Howe, he was, he's from Crow Creek Reservation. And this is really one of the first, you know, times when he really developed his skills and portrayed them here. So this is very, very historically important display of his work. From his upbringing, you know, he was able to capture the essence of Dakota culture here. I knew Oscar Howe. He was an artist in residence at the Over Museum in Vermilion when I was a student there in the 70s. And I used to like to visit him. He was not really a talkative person, though. he was not talkative, because he didn't really need to speak a lot, because he shared everything about himself, and it's right here. It's right here, because he had all this information, all this feeling within himself.
Oscar Howe's legacy of the murals is still part of the namesake of Mobridge's Old School Arena. The other part of the building name comes from local wrestling legends Jim and Bill Scher. The twin brothers would go on and compete in the 1988 Olympics.
Neither of them ever forgot their roots here in Mobridge. They have uncles and aunts that still live here. They have cousins that still live here. Bill married a local girl, okay? Their families are still here. But they come back all the time. But even when they were in college, they would come back and they would, I would turn practice over to them, you know? And say, hey, what'd you guys learn? Show us what we need to be doing. And so they would come back, and that became a tradition that all of our graduating seniors would come back.
In 2010, high school sporting events moved to a new gymnasium at the new Mobridge High School. But the Scher Howe Arena still stands to this day. It's now both an athletic and cultural symbol, with memories that will stand the test of time.
It is a museum. It's got historic art. And, you know, perhaps the most important thing about it now, because it's the part of its originality, you know, it came with it when it was new, but it's also a part of the present. And the gym floor, the baskets, it's, you know, that's a part of the past.
SDPB is committed to telling great stories that surround high school sports and activities in South Dakota on a yearly basis. To check out more of our video features, go to sdpb.org/basketball. We'll take a timeout. We'll set you up for our next game, Huron against Watertown. It's the boys' AA basketball tournament right here on SDPB3.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
What does primary care mean to us? At Sanford Health, it means being there when and where you need it most. It means building a relationship, because when a provider really knows you, they can deliver the best care for every aspect of your health and your life. So what does primary care mean for you? It means understanding your health for today and for where you're headed next. It means a lifetime of care for a lifetime of you.
Established in 1986, the Great Plains Tribal Leaders Health Board represents 18 tribal communities located in South Dakota, North Dakota, Nebraska, and Iowa. Our vision is that all tribal nations, communities, and citizens achieve optimal wellness through the embrace of traditional cultural values and innovative and holistic healing practices, strengthened by tribal sovereignty. For more information on our grant programs, health services, and career opportunities, visit our website at greatplainstribalhealth.org.
The way humans make sense of the world is through stories.
We've got to go ahead and start training to go to Mars.
And lift off.
We pay tribute to all who serve and who have served.
Civilization is precious. Life is precious.
Artists here are making a difference.
I'm trying to seek redemption.
Welcome back inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, as we continue on day two of this AA Boys State Basketball Tournament here on SDPB. We move on to our second game here on Friday. This will be Watertown versus Huron, both teams suffering disappointing losses on day one, but both teams eager to show what they're capable of. Tim Buttonhagen's team, a very physical contest last night against Brandon Valley. Hung with them throughout much of that game, Steve, but it kind of slipped away. 63-48 late in that one as Brandon Valley advanced. Huron now a chance to pick up their first win of the tournament. Still a very respectable 13-8 record on the season. There you see some of their key matchups throughout the year. Had that loss against Harrisburg on January 16th. It really has been a very good basketball team since then. They're showing, especially with that win against number 11 O'Gorman at 62-51, that they can compete with some of the best offenses in the AA.
Yeah, Huron lost twice to Watertown on the regular season, 59-35. That was on January 23rd. Then they met late in the year, February 16th, Watertown winning 67-56. So they got a, hopefully, third time's a charm if you're a Huron Tiger fan. Boating, Gainey, McNeil, Porish, and Elwine. That's your starting lineup, a pretty young starting lineup. Two seniors, a junior, freshman, and a sophomore. And Elwine, he's their top scorer, averages nearly 18 a game, held in check to 7. But he had 8 block shots yesterday, and we've been trying to find out if that's a state tournament record. We haven't found any documentation yet. But I don't know, 8 blocks in one game at a state tournament is pretty doggone good.
Yeah, I don't know that we've seen a block party from anybody in an individual performance like we saw in that one last night. What kind of repeat performance will the big man have today for the Huron Tigers? Let's see who his opponent will be. These Watertown Arrows had to wait 9 years to get back to the state tournament, but here they are in 2024. This Watertown team had a great season heading into this state basketball tournament, and still really have had good offensive year all around. 13-8 on the year and have had some big wins down the stretch. Had a 4-game winning streak snapped in the final game of the regular season against Harrisburg, and got a nice win, although a very low scoring affair against Sioux Falls Lincoln, 31-28 in the Sodak 16. That opening round loss against Harrisburg, though, 71-56 final. That's just one team they have not been able to overcome this season, but now a chance to face Huron here today and show that they can compete with some of the best teams at the AA level.
Dylan Rodden had 21 points yesterday. He is their main scorer. Cohen Krantz, a 3-point specialist. Marcus Rabine is in a bit of foul trouble. Jake Olson, Caden Beauchamp, they're the other scorers. They got no bench points yesterday, did the Arrows. 17 from Krantz, 11 from Beauchamp. Those were the top three scores, along with Rodden's 21 points for the Watertown Arrows.
Yeah, two good offenses that we're going to get to see on the court here today. Both teams with 13 wins, very similar, and I'm excited to see this one because of the size matchup. Has a chance to be a really fun game here today with the size and speed that both teams bring. See what they bring after the starting lineups. Let's turn it over to our public address announcer.
The Activities Association, along with its corporate partner Lake Area Tech College, welcomes you to this session of the State Boy AA High School Basketball Tournament. This tournament is being conducted under the guidance and regulation of the South Dakota High School Activities Association for the enjoyment and benefit of high school students. Good sportsmanship is essential for the success of these programs. We hope you enjoy the game and support your athletes in a positive and sportsmanlike manner. This game features the Tigers of Huron and the Arrows of Watertown. And now let's meet the starting lineups in alternating fashion. For the Tigers, at guard, a 5'11 junior, number 12, Colton McNeil. For the Arrows at guard, 6 foot senior number 4, Dylan Rodden. For the Tigers at guard, 6 foot senior number 14, Gavin Moding. For the Arrows at forward, 6'3 senior number 5, Kanan Beauchamp. For the Tigers at guard, 6'1 senior number 24, CJ Gainey. For the Arrows at guard, 6 foot senior number 10, Cohen Kranz. For the Tigers at forward, 6'8 sophomore number 30, Blake Elwine. For the Arrows at forward, 6'1 senior number 15, Marcus Rabine. For the Tigers at guard, 6'3 freshman number 32, Anderson Borish. And for the Arrows at forward, 6'2 senior number 20, Jake Olson. The Tigers are led by Tim Buddenhagen, assistant coaches Jim Noye, Spencer Staley, and Bryce Anderson. The Arrows are led by Pat McClemens, assistant coaches Matty Kranz, Tommy Mattingly, Zach Tobin, and Parker Schmidt. Your officials for this game, Jeff Hentler, Chad DeYoung, and Andrew Gross.
You heard it, it's go time. These two teams ready to go. Our 7-6 matchup today between Huron and Watertown. It'll be the Arrows in their home whites today with the purple letters and gold trim. Huron will wear their black uniforms tonight with the orange letters and white trim. Tip goes to Huron, and we are underway inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center. I'm JJ Hartigan, he's Steve Toome. This is SDPB's coverage of AA Boys State Basketball. Left corner three, no good. Rebounded by the Arrows, and they're off in transition. This one off the glass, and their point guard, Dylan Rodden, is going to be huge today. The senior, standing at 6 foot, puts the first points on the board.
We'll see how the pace goes, because these teams have the short turnaround after losing last night. Especially Huron, they played the late game, and that was a very physical game.
It certainly was. They were up and down the floor throughout the night. Had to exhaust a lot of energy throughout this game. That young man stepped up, and as the game went on, got more comfortable. Just a sophomore at 6'8", misses his first shot of the day, but that's a player we're going to be watching throughout this one. Blake Elwine, a sophomore guard, playing down in the post right now defensively as he goes to work against Watertown. This is a size matchup that maybe favors Huron slightly today, but again, you said it, they had a very physical game, and there's that block we were waiting for, his first of the day. Elwine had 8 yesterday and got tangled up in the jump ball there. Possession arrow favoring Watertown. They will retain it, and Coach Buddenhagen pacing the sidelines already, getting his thoughts in on this one.
Yeah, he will. He's one of those active coaches,
yes,
on the sideline. He will rarely be seated, and now the officials will confer here. Early on, 2-0 Watertown, and not sure what they're conversing about.
Yeah, they're wondering about the shot clock reset here, making sure that everything is correct. Clock ready to go. We are 2-0 your score early on. Watertown got the bucket there in that transition.
Ooh, over and back.
Over and back on the baseline, stepping there after the ball was touched. Possession never changed, and Rodden perplexed, but it is a turnover.
Yep, so it's, you know, anytime you get those ESD schools, you know, the Hurons, the Watertowns, schools that they're the traditional rivals, it's going to be a grudge match. These guys play against each other in all the different sports, much like the Sioux Falls schools. And there's that tradition, 100 plus years of tradition for these particular schools.
Elwine will try a three. It hangs on the rim, but does not fall. Gainey, a big player in last night's game, number 24, going D up top of the key there against Rabine. That's going to be a fun matchup today. Driving inside now. Olson had his shot miss. Elwine into the front court. There's Gainey.
Gainey's so quick.
Right-handed release off the left side of the paint. Hangs on the rim, but does not fall. Both teams starting a little cold from the field today. Huron now 0-4. Watertown, 1-2. Now 1-3 on the day are the Arrows.
Olson was open underneath, but he had to drift to the outside to take that pass. The opening in the middle closed up.
Good zip around the top of the key here for Watertown as they move it around. Everybody's touched it. This one inside. Nice finish there for Beauchamp.
Yep, you pull the bigger men, Anderson, Porish, and Elwine away, and then you try to get that little cut so those big shot blockers aren't in there for Huron.
Danny connects from deep, the first three of the day for either team, and Huron erases an 0-for-4 start.
When Ganey is really contributing, that's when Huron's at his best. You know you're going to get Porish and Elwine to contribute, but Ganey's that X-factor guy, young man that's heading to Northern to play football.
Almost 3 minutes gone by as they go to work again inside. Watertown has not tried a three yet today. Here's their first attempt. This one off the front side of the iron, no good.
But there was a double team down low, and that was Beauchamp who had the open look. Took his time.
Elwine streaking inside, and a nice finish there. Credit the assist to Colton McNeil, the junior guard. His first dime of the day, and there's Elwine, the 6'8", again listed as a guard. One of the tallest players at this tournament, playing aggressively at the top of the key.
Yep, he's going to be guarding Wadden, and now he'll switch off in that man-to-man.
We mentioned the youth movement going on in Huron as we see a bucket and a nice finish inside there. Mitch Olson lays it home. Check that, excuse me. That was Rabine, I beg your pardon. Yep. Rabine with the finish.
Yeah, Rabine was in a bit of foul trouble yesterday. Yep. Really didn't have a chance to contribute. Watertown's one of those teams that they'll get everybody involved. They're not, you know, Rodden's their main scorer, but they got a lot of different guys that contribute. What hurt Watertown yesterday was no bench points.
Spin move from the free throw line there, no good. Yeah, gotta get your bench involved throughout the tournament at some point. You know you're gonna need those legs, especially early on. Here on day two, they look strong. 6-5, 3:48 left to go as we get to the media timeout. We'll step aside from Sioux Falls. More AA basketball coming your way in just a moment.
Dreamer, doer, difference maker. These are just a few things we look for when growing our team at Dakota Bank. Those with empathy and a commitment to doing what's right build their careers with us. If you're about relationships and helping others, Dakota Bank is calling. Will you answer? Go with integrity. Go with teamwork. Go with Dakota Bank.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is as I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our, you know, our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
SDPB recorded the state high school gymnastics competition last month. You can watch the highlights featuring top individual performances from each apparatus as SDPB presents the South Dakota High School Gymnastic Championships. That's on Sunday at 1 Central Noon Mountain. SDPB 1 Television.
Arrows coming out of the media timeout there. 3 of 6 from the field so far today.
Man to man for Huron. See how they switch around, and there's Elwine on Wadden. Let's see if they switch.
Watertown's been very patient on the offensive side so far. They've been willing to take these shot clocks down. It's at 10. Now looking maybe to get more aggressive here with 7. Elwine got his hand on that one again and tipped it into the backcourt. Shot clock's at 2. Gonna have to get it up. They do release in time. That one off the front side of the iron and no good. The offense continues to hold possession, though, at the full reset. Now swinging it around. Left side 3, no good. And there, Anderson Porish, the freshman guard at 6'3". Another young player who's been playing a lot of minutes for this Huron team. But boy, offense aplenty there. There were several opportunities for the Arrows to get points on the board. This Huron team, though, very aggressive defensively, Steve.
Yeah, and credit Peyton Bisker for coming in and get that last offensive rebound for the Arrows. He wears number 24, just checked into the game.
Danny drawing another one. That's his sweet spot. It's a 2 from distance on that left side.
Quick release, high arc on the shot.
2:45 left to go now here in this opening quarter of action. Starting to heat up a little bit offensively. Huron with the two-point lead. That one hangs but doesn't fall.
That was Engstrom who got the shot there.
And he'll go to the free throw line for the first time today. 0-1 from the field so far.
Ganey collects the first foul for Huron.
We mentioned bench being so important. Engstrom, 0-3 yesterday from the field.
Yeah, that's the first bench point in the tournament for the Arrows on that free throw.
Yeah. Again, we said they were going to need it over the course of 3 days. It's a lot of basketball to be played. You rely on your starters a lot, but at some point you got to get these guys involved, and seeing the senior step up. Chance to tie it here now, and he does. 8-8 your score with 2:39 to go in the first quarter.
Huron, their last state title, 2004. Watertown, their last title, 2008. That's a nice move to the bucket.
Really think they've got to be excited in Huron about what these young players are bringing. Blake Elwine, another bucket, with 6'8 sophomore. You've got Porsche, the freshman, 6'3. There's a lot of size, a lot of room to grow still within this program. Arrows slowing down the offense again with 15 on the shot clock. Caught inside. Ganey got his hands on it. It's recovered. That shot missed from his backside. Keeping it alive, though. Beauchamp showing some athleticism there.
Yep, and wise not to try to get up.
Brought in around to the right side. Now they find Engstrom. His three off the mark, but a rebound there by Torgerson. Three from the top of the key's no good. Elwine with the rebound defensively. Ganey out into the front court quickly. He'll step back, thought about the three. Now Engstrom on the attack. The left-handed scoop is good. The bucket and the foul, and a chance at a three-point play the old-fashioned way.
I love what they're doing with Elwine and getting him to drive to the bucket, as that foul will be on Beauchamp. Watch him drive down the lane and get around the defender. He's got a quick step for a guy with long legs. Last night, Brandon Valley, you know, just bottled him up, and the outside shots weren't falling for him, so now they're getting him to move to the bucket, and he can elevate over the shorter players for the Arrows.
First free throw attempt of the day for the Tigers, and it's a good one. Elwine with 7 points now. He's 3-5 from the field. He looks a lot more confident out there today, a lot more comfortable. He seems to be in his element. Get the pressure of day one at the state tournament off your back, and now you can just go back and ball out. It seems like these Tigers have brought it here today. Nice bounce pass inside, blocked by Elwine, his second so far in this one, his 10th of the tournament.
We're going to have to find some documentation on that. We've been trying to find it. We haven't found it yet, but 10 blocks and counting.
Elwine high off the glass, no. Ganey wants to push it, now pulls back, and it gets pulled away from him. Coming in from behind was Engstrom. He'll try to go coast to coast. Off the glass, and look out, collisions. Bodies falling everywhere, and a foul on the play.
And they're going to tag that on Porish, I believe. Blocking foul.
This has been a physical first quarter of play between these two teams. 6-7. Another trip to the free throw line for the Tigers, for Watertown. This will be Engstrom back at the line. He's been there already once today, 2-for-2.
64% on the year.
All of his points at the line, as you see the subs checking in.
Colton Ogle, number 22, making his first appearance. Also number 20, that's Holden Hegg. He's a senior, Ogle a senior as well. And then Moting back into the game.
Watertown, one for their last nine from the field. They've been staying alive at the free throw line, although that one misses there. Engstrom now 3-of-4 at the stripe. Under a minute to go, shot clock still on in this opening quarter of action. Watertown would love a stop here to try to get one final shot. Make this a one possession game. The Tigers want to extend this lead. Nice dish inside, floating that one with some contact. It doesn't go, but it will get him to the free throw line. Foul on the play.
And that foul will be on Mitch Olson, one of the reserves for Watertown, number 12. Colton Ogle did not score last night.
6'3 senior will put this one up a little short and misses. Just checked in a moment ago. He'll get another chance at the stripe here.
Ogle on the year, 88% at the free throw line.
Second one off the backside of the iron. Arrows will have a chance for the final shot. Shot clock is turned off. Engstrom into the front court, will hand it off. Engstrom running the offense here, playing a little catch with his teammate Roden. Now he'll reset near the top. 15 left to go in this opening quarter. Watertown down by four. Chance to make this a one-point, or at least a one-possession game heading into quarter number two.
7 seconds left.
Down to five now. They're nowhere near where they want to be to shoot. They'll get one away from the left wing. That one too strong, though. And boy, Huron really played lockdown defense there at the end of the quarter. They take a 13-9 lead into quarter number two. We'll be back with more from Sioux Falls in just a moment.
You've worked hard to build your business, your reputation, your success. Your financial partner should be committed to digging in to drive your vision forward. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
A community is more than buildings. It's where you live, where you work. Community is being there for each other, lending a hand when your neighbors are in need. Community is all of us coming together for a greater purpose. This is community. This is Lloyd.
Welcome back inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center. Well, Huron, we have a problem. That was last night. Tonight, as they bring that Apollo 13 look here, they've got a 13-point start to their day. 13-9 your score. Watertown right now 0 of 6 from three-point land, though, Steve. They've had five different players shoot a three-point shot. Hasn't fallen yet, though. That maybe got to change if they want to get back into this one.
Yeah, Watertown only 21% of the floor. Huron at 50%. But they've only had two players score. And looks like we're going to have a foul there as Porish went up for the shot.
Yeah, you can see that ball kind of came out of his hand awkwardly. He knew contact was there. The officials send him to the free throw line.
Yeah, Elwine and Ganey have been the only players that have scored. Porish, he had 10 points, 6 rebounds last night.
First one off the front side of the iron. Huron has started the day now 1 of 4 from the free throw line.
This young man, just a freshman, 67% on the season at the charity stripe.
That one's good. Huron still shooting 50% from the field, 5 of 10 on the day. Watertown, 3 of 14. They'll look to get it inside here. Had some trouble at the final shot there of any, even getting anything close to the three-point arc. Huron has been playing great defense, although a slip there. Nice pass inside, contested though by Porish. Good defense again from the Tigers.
Yep, that's Hegg and Ogle providing some tough defense out there.
Speaking of tough defense, Cohen Kranz got his hands on that one, and then a foul as Elwine trying to recover.
Yep, and that will be his first personal foul. Looks like Huron's going to apply a little pressure in the backcourt here. We'll see how serious it is. If it's just going to back away. Looks like it's just token pressure here, and they'll slip back into man-to-man.
Roden walks it across the half-court line. He works left side now. The size matchup there with Elwine. They want to get the ball out of the hands of Rowan. Now he makes a move towards the hoop. That one got contested. Three black jerseys in the area. Good defensive pressure again from the Tigers.
Yeah, they tried to pass it to Beauchamp, and it was just bottled up there by all those Huron defenders. Good interior defense.
Huron slowing it down a little bit here now with this five-point lead. They work it inside. Tough defense again. Kranz, his hand on the basketball, and a foul. It's a couple possessions now in this second quarter where Kranz has really created some havoc out there in the backcourt defensively.
Yeah, again, interior passing. Both teams trying to make something happen inside, and the opposing defense able to take the ball away. Both teams score right at 55 points per game, so the pace kind of, you know, both teams comfortable at this pace. Oh, nice fake.
Watertown, four offensive rebounds today, but they haven't turned it into second chance points yet. Zero in that category right now. 10 on the shot clock, that pass up to the top of the key, taken away. Going in with the finger roll finish. Nice bucket there for Gavin Moding. And timeout on the floor.
Yep, Watertown calls this timeout.
It'll be a full timeout with 6:08 left to go. Take a look at this one again as Moding, soft finish.
Yep, was not intimidated by the man coming in behind him. You know, tomorrow night, we're gonna be handing out some awards, the Spirit of Six. Today would have been Sue Ann Big Crow's 50th birthday.
Wow.
And of course, that's who the Spirit of Sioux is named after. And I still remember, I can't specifically remember. I remember I was in my car driving over to some friend's place, heard the news on the radio of her tragic death, and it just hit you like a punch to the stomach. It just, oh no.
Yeah.
Oh, you just couldn't believe that terrible news. And we miss Sue Ann Big Crow to this day. And of course, the award handed out at both the girls and boys basketball tournaments to a senior. It's not about how good a player they are. It's about their leadership, their community involvement. And we will have that award tomorrow night at halftime of the championship game.
Yep.
But I just read that note there. She would have been 50 years old today.
For those who don't know, the Spirit of Sioux is widely considered the highest honor an athlete can get, I think, in the state of South Dakota. It's just one of those things that just
It
brings respect when you hear it connected to somebody's name. And there have been some of the best people in the state of South Dakota who have earned those awards. We talk about them as athletes because that's kind of the field that they win it in, but it comes down to character, and that speaks volumes about who Sue Ann Big Crow was, what that award means to the people of South Dakota.
Her legacy lives on, and again, it's not to the best player. That's Mr. and Miss Basketball, as we got a foul there. No, it's palming the ball. Turnover, arrows. There's a lot more that goes into the Spirit of Sioux Award. And we'll learn more about that tomorrow night as, again, a heavily contested contest here between Huron and between Watertown.
Saw Coach Budenhagen there. He's liking what he's seeing from his guys here so far today. Always an intense individual over there. Demands hustle, heart from his team, and they've brought it today. This one tried to go big time on that one, a little too strong with the pass off the glass. Now this in transition gets tipped out of bounds. Nice recovery by Huron defensively. Talked about that side of the basketball a lot today, but good defense leads to good things on offense, and that's a big reason why they've got a 7-point lead right now.
Yeah, the defense from Huron has been really impressive. They've been playing pretty much man-to-man the entire game, and they've, you know, been really solid with, you know, switching off, staying in front of their defenders, or in, you know, in front of the offensive player.
5.5 minutes left to go. Arrows trying to prod their way inside. They'll settle for another three, and it's too strong. Gainey outletting this one. Moding into the front court, playing a little catch with Gainey now. It's Moding bouncing it inside. Porish, the extra dribble around.
Yes.
Got the defender in the air to finish off the glass.
Good execution by Huron. Patience in the paint with some good passing.
Tigers are shooting over 50% in the half. Nice pass, but again contested by Gainey in spot inside. We wondered what their legs would look like heading into this game today because they were the final game of the day yesterday. Now playing in the early afternoon session today, they look like they're just fine out there right now running the floor.
Yep, their intensity on defense has been top notch.
This one up near the free throw line. The jumper hangs on the rim but doesn't go. Elwine with the rebound.
That was a good play set up by the arrows. The guy had the wide open look. It just rattled out.
7 points, 5 rebounds today for Elwine. Gainey will try another three from the sweet spot. That one just a little strong off the backside of the iron. He's hit two from that spot already today. His first miss from distance.
Ooh.
Dangerous pass there, and Gainey got his hands on it, but also got a little skin that time. Tagged him with the foul on the reach in. 9-point lead with under 5 minutes left to go in this first half. We will step aside for a moment and be back with the final 4:32 after this.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. they build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it, while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today.
Dakota Plains New Holland dealers proudly support high school athletics.
There you see fans of the Watertown Arrows trying to get their guys back into this game with 4:32 left to go. 18-9 your score. Arrows are ready to eat, trying to find a way to get some points from deep, though, Steve. The three-point bucket continues to elude Watertown here in the first half.
Yeah, 0-7 from the floor. Meanwhile, Huron 2-5 from three-point land, but Watertown really struggling from the floor, 3-17, and Dylan Rodden just has not gotten any open looks, and the way that Huron's switching on him, a lot of the times it's Elwine, the big 6'8 player guarding him. But, I mean, they've really done a good job on him defensively. He is the main weapon for the Arrows, number four.
Watertown 3-17 from the field overall, trying to change it here, and they do. That's a nice finish there.
Engstrom.
Yeah, Will Engstrom, senior guard, 5'11". Again, hadn't scored from the field, got all of his points at the free throw line early on, but has made a contribution here today offensively with 5 points now. Back to a 6-point game. That one loose on the floor. Arrows come away with it. Nice battle down low that time. Cohen Kranz again creating havoc defensively. Yeah, Beauchamp.
Yeah, Kranz I don't think has scored yet, but boy, he has been a difference maker on defense.
There's Engstrom again driving inside. Scoop shot. He's feeling it. Brought his team back within four. He's got back-to-back buckets and has turned into the leading scorer today now for the Watertown Arrows.
Yeah, he's got 8 points, top man for the Arrows so far. Averages 6.7 points per game, so he is capable of scoring, and he's really carrying the team right now.
It's his first bucket from inside the arc. It started the day 1-for-4 from three-point land. Now this one, a foul on the play. The bucket will count. Chance at a three-point play now.
Holden Hegg. Foul on Watertown's Jake Olson.
Hegg with his first shot from the field today, as you see their contact on the way up.
Holden Hegg missed a lot of time throughout the course of his high school career. 2 shoulder surgeries.
He's played just 4 minutes today, but this to make it a 3-possession lead again for Huron. It will stay a 6-point lead with 3:25 left to go. Quickly into the front court they go now. Engstrom works his way inside, double teamed, and yeah, picked up the pivot foot, slipped a little bit underneath the baseline there, and gets called for the travel.
Good defense by Huron to bottle him up along the baseline, and Engstrom kind of got a little off balance there, and no open teammate to make a pass to.
Huron's best run as far as win streak this season was a 4-game stretch. Second half of the year had wins over Spearfish, Sturgis, Pier TF Riggs and Aberdeen Central. They've won 6 of their last 8 games. And are riding high offensively here in this first half.
And that's Holden Hegg scoring again. And Hegg has made a nice contribution today.
A spin move back outside they go now. Beauchamp swings it around. Engstrom's had the hot hand. He'll look to hand it off. Tough defense from the Tigers now with 10 on the shot clock again. Making his move, driving inside. Kranz kicks it back out. Engstrom stops, pops this one off the backside of the iron. Elwine thought about pushing it, now slows up for a moment. Back inside he goes. Looking for help now, trying to find an open shooter as Hegg. They'll swing it back to the top of the key, still time. Elwine got two defenders in front of him, got one on top of him, and now, ooh, they'll say traveling.
Shuffled the pivot foot there.
There was plenty of contact on the way up, but traveled before. He looks a little frustrated. His team, though, still up 22-14 with 2:12 left to go here in the first half.
Porish will replace Hegg, or Anderson, yeah, Anderson Porish in for Hegg.
Yep.
Hegg gave him good minutes there.
Huron dominating this game inside the paint right now, 14 of their 22 points in the paint. They've hit a couple big threes when they've needed, 2 of 5 today from three-point land. Arrows 1 of 8, got their first one to fall a short while ago with Engstrom, who leads the way with 8 points. Nobody else with more than 2 right now, though, for Watertown. They're looking for help near the top of the key, and a foul's going to be called on Huron. It's going to be Colton Ogle, the senior guard, picks up the personal.
That is the fourth team foul on Huron, so it's free throws from here on out. Final 2 minutes of the half, if Watertown can draw another foul on the Tigers.
Fresh 35 on the shot clock, and the Arrows will inbound it just in front of the Huron bench.
Now Ganey's going to switch over and guard Rodden. That's a good one-on-one matchup.
Top of the key, they'll swing it around. Looking for a little help inside. Boy, they have been bottling up those post players. Beauchamp has been almost taken out of this game completely in the first half. Now a foul. Left side of the paint. We'll see who this is on. I think it's going to be Carson Evans.
Yes, it will. That means free throws coming up here for the Arrows. 15 foul on the Tigers.
Both he and Elwine were trying to bottle up the shooter, Jake Olson, who goes to the line here with chance to get his team a little bit closer. 22-14 your score now. The free throw is good there. Watertown 4 of 5 at the free throw line so far today. They've been connecting. They've been good at the line throughout the tournament.
Olson on the year, 74% at the free throw line. That was his first point of the afternoon.
Both of them are good.
The average is a little over 9 points, 5 rebounds per game, and it's been relatively quiet in this contest.
Two possession game as Elwine goes in, tries the scoop shot with the right hand, got tangled up and doesn't come away with points, but will go back to the free throw line for a couple more. He's only had one attempt at the stripe so far today, but 7 points, 6 rebounds, 2 blocks, 14 minutes of action. It's a solid stat line. That's a game stat line some nights for guys across the state.
That's his first point of the second quarter. Beauchamp's going to have to leave, and Rabine replaces him.
Minute 34 left to go now is Elwine. Up to 9 points in this first half. Timeout called. It'll be a 30-second timeout called by Huron.
I'm very impressed with the way Huron has played, especially defensively in this contest. And it's been pretty much man-to-man the entire time for the Tigers.
The interesting thing, Huron 7 turnovers on the day. Watertown just 5. Watertown's played some tough defense, too. It's just Huron, again, those threes have been a big difference maker here in this first half.
Your passport to great programming is available online with SDPB Passport. You can access hundreds of hours of programs you can't see anywhere else. Your gift of only $5 a month grants you access to shows from Masterpiece to the entire collection of Ken Burns documentaries and a whole lot more. Make a gift and get started today. Learn more at sdpb.org/passport.
Buck 34 left to go in this first half. Now 24-16, your score. Huron, the sixth seed, has come in and been electric offensively so far today. 9 of 15 from the field at 60% in this first half. They've been tough defensively, holding Watertown to just 25% shooting. Buddenhagen wanted a push off there. Play continues on with 18 now on the shot clock.
Huron stretching out that defense.
Engstrom getting it inside. Players slipping as Rabine hands it off. That got tipped away as Krantz tried to cut inside the lane. Now Elwine into the front court. Stops for the three. That one off the backside of the iron. Porish the rebound. Elwine with it again, but that got poked away. Olson with the steal. Now stops on a dime and waits for his teammates to recover. Three from Engstrom off the front side of the iron. No. Down to 45 seconds remaining in this first half. Nifty footwork from the 6'8 guard. He goes in, gets fouled. Boy, you can see why they let him play the guard position. Blake Elwine, the sophomore, stands at 6'8. Real smooth cuts inside the lane that time and has a chance for a couple more free throws.
Rabine with the foul. That is his first.
Elwine, 9.7 rebounds today. That gives him 10.
Yep, for Blake Elwine, of course, his dad, Jay Elwine, an All-State player for Huron, who was on that state championship team in 93, as we get a sub to the scores table. His mom is Raven Morgan from Mitchell, who was an All-State player for Mitchell, had a great career at Dakota Wesleyan. And I got to say, Raven Morgan is one heck of a cool name. Sounds like a spy.
Your son's playing well here today. Huron with the 26-16 lead, a 10-point lead now. 30 seconds left to go. Arrows with about a 4-second difference between shot clock and game clock will try to play this down as close to the wire as they can here. Get it to single digits by halftime, you're in a good spot. Driving, looking inside, Roden gets fouled on his way up with 9 on the shot clock.
It's kind of twisting in midair, but managed to get that foul drawn on Carson Evans, who just was a little bit out of position. I tell you what, Dylan Rodden, he's been quiet. He had 21 yesterday, but only 2 so far. Make a 3.
A few subs checking back in. Gainey will get one last look here, maybe at an offensive 3-point bucket as he tries to help stabilize the offense. Arrows thinking the same thing with Mitch Olson coming in for defensive purposes.
Yeah, plenty of time for Huron here should they either have to bring the ball up after a make or get a rebound.
That one goes in. Roden now with 4 points on the day. Down to the final 10 seconds. Elwine into the court. Drives inside the paint, kicks it out. There is Gainey for a 3-point look. Left it a little short. Arrows with 3 seconds left. They get it into the front court, but that too strong over the head of Cohen Krantz. And that's how your first half will come to an end. 26-18 your score. Huron with the advantage into the locker room at halftime. We'll step aside and be back with more AA boys basketball in just a moment.
As much as you have accomplished, there are times you'd rather not go it alone. While you determine what direction you go, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with community. Go with neighbors. Go with understanding. Go with support.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is as I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our livestock, our pigs is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy. So we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
What does primary care mean to us? At Sanford Health, it means being there when and where you need it most. It means building a relationship, because when a provider really knows you, they can deliver the best care for every aspect of your health and your life. So what does primary care mean for you? It means understanding your health for today and for where you're headed next. It means a lifetime of care for a lifetime of you.
Anthem Oats in Frederick is a proud community partner and supports high school activities in South Dakota. The Sumptions have been stewards of the soil since 1882. From the family farm right to your pantry. AnthemOats.com.
Beginning April 6th, watch SDPB Saturday evenings for a new lineup of shows. Start the night laughing with Keeping Up Appearances at 5, 4 Mountain. Then, the drama unfolds, with back-to-back episodes of Midsummer Murders tag along with private investigator Alexa Cross in My Life is Murder at 7, 6 Mountain, followed by the fan favorites Doc Martin and Father Brown. Plus, Sister Boniface joins us on Sunday evenings at 6, 5 Mountain.
Back inside the Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, AA boys basketball. We're halftime on day two in our second game of day two in this matchup between Watertown and Huron. And boy, Steve, Huron came out looking real nice offensively. A 26-18 lead here at halftime. The Arrows had their moments, though, in this first half. Got some points early on. Three-point was a struggle today, though, for the Arrows. They're going to have to get that figured out if they want to get back in this game.
Yeah, a lot of the paint's been scored inside today, especially by the Tigers. Elwine with a couple of really, really nice drives. He just goes over the Watertown defenders, and there's another block by Elwine. He had a couple of them. Nice run out there by Moding after he got the steal. Porish, that was a nifty move in the paint as the defender went by him. Outside shot knocked down by Engstrom, who led the team with 8 points coming off the bench for Watertown as he got the reverse layup there. He's been the catalyst so far for Watertown, who's struggling from the floor. 24% on 5 of 21 shooting. Meanwhile, Huron much more efficient at 53%. Three-point field goals, not really a factor for either team. Free throws, kind of a wash. Both teams doing well there. Rebounding's even. Turnovers, a couple of more for Huron. But again, the shooting for Watertown just hasn't been there. Huron has been very, very solid defensively.
Yeah, it's been a good showing for the Tigers so far. They'll look to keep it going in quarter number three. We're at halftime right now. 26-18 your score as we step aside again. Back with more AA boys basketball in just a moment.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do, and that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
Oh my goodness.
We're trying to promote the Descendants of Doom tour, you know, trying to make everybody look kind of metal and, you know.
Menacing, menacing.
The band just got covered by Delta Dental, so they kind of can't stop smiling.
They need to look more metal, and they don't look metal. What do we do?
Pop off a few more, see what we get.
Give me some metal.
All right, yeah. 3, 2, 1.
Delta Dental!
We're all going somewhere. Going higher, faster, farther. Going in new directions, to new places. At Monument Health, we keep going so you can keep going. We're dedicated to advanced orthopedic care with the latest innovations, technology, expertise, and treatment. So keep exploring. Keep making memories. Keep going with Monument Health as your partner. Learn more at monument.health/orthopedics.
Welcome back inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. We are at halftime right now between Watertown and Huron. It's been some good games already played today, Steve, but South Dakota knows that they've got a lot of good basketball, and they've been able to tell stories about tales from the hardwood across the state.
You bet, because high school basketball is such a huge part of what represents our communities and towns all across South Dakota. You can join SDPB as we take you on a journey into some of the stories about the players and teams that surround our basketball courts here in the Mount Rushmore State. From honoring a longtime coach to a student manager whose skills extend to a much different kind of court, you'll also meet a player who's turned coach and see how one student athlete has dealt with a unique disability. You can find all about this and more on this year's edition of Tales from the Hardwood, a program available online at sdpb.org/basketball. And don't forget, you can become a member of SDPB today. First Bank and Trust, with support from Van and Barb Fishback, are inviting you to support high school sports on SDPB. Your new member donation will automatically be matched, doubling your gift. Take advantage of this match by donating today at sdpb.org And you can also call 1-800-777-0789.
So this will be the final game of our day session here on day two. We've got some exciting basketball coming your way later tonight, though, here on SDPB3. We'll have, again, another great matchup. Mitchell versus Washington. That's a 1-5 matchup. That'll tip off our night session tonight at 6 o'clock. And then we'll cap things off with Harrisburg and Brandon Valley. So take a look at our bracket, the way things have shook up so far after day one in the quarterfinals. These are our semifinals tonight. Somebody will be crowned champion by weekend's end. We'll find out. Number one, Mitchell, looks like the real deal. Harrisburg, they were fantastic yesterday. Washington was in a tough battle with Roosevelt. We'll see what kind of shooting day they bring today against that number one seed. That'll be a tough challenge. And then Brandon Valley, of course, a lot of emotion with that team right now. They've gotten a lot of attention because of the unfortunate loss of their longtime head coach, Coach Deckert. So they're thinking about him, but found a way to get a win yesterday. At Harrisburg and Brandon Valley game, we expect this place to be packed and loud for that one at 7:45. Can't wait to bring you all the action again later on tonight here on SDPB.
You know, it's interesting, a matchup between Brandon Valley and Harrisburg when you look back at history. Brandon Valley, back in the late 80s, they were the school that was Class A, moved up to Double A, and won a football championship, I believe, their first year in the 11 AA ranks when that was the top class. And then Harrisburg, here about 10 years ago, they were, you know, schools getting bigger and bigger. They moved up into the AA ranks, and they have actually played in all four 11-man championship football games. They haven't won a title in all of them, but they've played in 11B, and I believe they have won a title in 11B. They played in 11A, they've played in 11AA, and they played in 11AAA.
Unbelievable.
As that school has grown over the years. And I got to point this out because I am a proud alumni. Back in the fall of 1985, Harrisburg played in the 11B championship game. They were the favored team, and they lost to my hometown, the Scotland Highlanders. Ooh. Whereas Scotland's one of their three football championships. You know, I was going to get a Scotland reference in sometime during the weekend.
Cash that check. There we go.
Well, I got a reunion, high school reunion coming up here this August. Here is the class of 84. The ones you still adore are going to be having our reunion, and it's hard to believe it's been 40 years.
That's pretty incredible. Yeah, the history that Harrisburg has seen now just since moving up the ranks, man. And getting to be able to watch this program grow. They've had athletes within that school district for a long time. And it's going to be a fun one. We've got two great games coming your way tonight. This one, still two quarters to decide the final in this AA matchup today. One team will take on Sioux Falls Jefferson in the Consolation Championship at 1:45. The other will face Roosevelt at high noon tomorrow in our seventh place game. Want to come away with a victory here on day two to at least give yourself a chance to pick up two wins at the state tournament.
Yeah, this is definitely anybody's games. And the Arrows, they haven't looked as efficient on offense in this game as they did last night in that matchup against Harrisburg.
Watertown's going to have their first chance at it and trying to get their big man involved. He was held relatively in check in that first half.
Yeah, Beauchamp. They only had 2 points, and he just got blocked there, and I think that was Elwine, so that's block number three for him.
11 blocks in this tournament so far over six quarters of basketball.
Boy, Rodden just has not been open at all. He's only had one field goal.
Got to get him going, got to get Beauchamp going, and this offense will start to flow. There's Rodden driving inside. He'll float one with the left hand. Defender fell behind a little bit in his pursuit, and Rodden, a much-needed bucket there to get his team back within six.
Yeah, he's the man that's really got to get going offensively for the Arrows if they want to get back into this one. And also Cohen Kranz, he was shut out. And again, that's just a result of good defense by the Tigers because, you know, Kranz didn't, I don't even think he had a shot attempt. He didn't have any decent looks at all. I mean, that defense bottled him up.
They're doing a good job bottling up Elwine here. He'll have to kick it across court. Three from the left wing, too strong. Ganey unable to track that one down. It's Kranz with the rebound, and now he'll push it in transition. There's a three-point attempt. That one off the left side of the iron, though, no good. Offensive rebound. Another opportunity inside for Jake Olson. Didn't hit the three, but comes up with two, and his team's back within four.
This team from Watertown, is that one almost stolen away. And we're going to have a foul on Watertown. Watertown has a lot of players that are kind of tweeners, you know, the 6'1", 6'2 guys. You know, they can play multiple positions. They don't have a whole lot of height. Now, they got some strong players in the middle, but, you know, is something that, you know, that Coach McClemmon says, hey, you know, we're not the biggest, the fastest team out there. You know, we're not going to have the pretty pictures of the guys who, look like they're star basketball players. But these kids play hard, and they play smart, and they're fundamentally sound, and that's what you got to be in order to win. Reminds me of a Bridgewater team from the early 80s. They were all 6'1", but boy, they could play basketball, and they were in the state B tournament.
Ganey can't hit on that one. It gets tipped out of bounds. It'll be Tigers basketball here with 6:25 to go.
I remember that game because they got matched up against Redfield, who had a 6'8 player. The tallest guy for Bridgewater is 6'1", but they held their own in that game.
Ganey wants another chance at three, and it's going to be an offensive foul this time. Tangled up, it's going to be Gavin Moding who picks up the personal.
Yeah, illegal screen there, and he's talking to his coach about that. And, you know, Watertown's showing some pretty good energy coming out of the break here. They've cut this lead down to just 4 points.
Moding with his second personal foul. 4-point game. Watertown has a chance to cut this to a one-possession contest if they can connect. They've come out red hot here in this third quarter. A little 4-0 run. Not truly a run until you get it to six. This one, long two, has a chance, and it goes. There's your run.
Rodden now with 8 points.
2-point game. It's game on. A little too much contact this time, and Olsen's going to get tagged with the personal foul.
It's only his second.
5:55 left to go. They're going to get Porish off the bench, sending him to the sideline now, Colton McNeil. Porish provides a little extra size inside for this Huron team. Moding feeds Elwine. Spinning, trying to clear out some space, now going to work again. Contact, offensive foul.
Yep.
You can see it pretty clear there as he tried to work his way inside. Working a little too hard with the offense that time, pushing off with the forearm. Does it again right here, and that's what got him.
Extending the forearm, that's what got him. Had he, you know, the thing is, had he held it close to his chest, he might have gotten away with it. But when that arm extends out and that player falls down, that's going to be an offensive foul.
Rodden, seeing what the defense will give him, not much. They look to pass it away as Olsen battles Porish. Well, the defense forcing the ball out around the perimeter. Good defense here from here on. Engstrom back outside. Three on the way. This one gives Watertown the lead. 27-26. It's a 1-point Arrows advantage with 5:15 left to go.
What a great run. Huron yet to score, but now they do.
The equalizer, Elwine, his fourth bucket of the day, and a chance at a 3-point play now. Perfect at the free throw line today. He's been making it count. That's a big bucket there.
And Cohen Kranz just got his third foul for Watertown. That is a big one.
Elwine, the leading scorer today, 13 points, 7 rebounds. 3 huge blocks, 6 for 6 at the free throw line.
Yeah, Kranz is going to have to check out in favor of the senior, Peyton Bisker, number 24, into the lineup. But that's a big offensive weapon that's on the bench now for the Arrows.
Rodden and Engstrom both with 8 points today to lead the charge offensively for Watertown. Somebody else is going to have to step up. And now foul is going to be called on Elwine as he reached in. Engstrom has been that steady hand today, Steve, and he's providing it there offensively. Even without points, he's creating opportunities now for Watertown.
And for Elwine, that is his third personal foul.
Rodden will inbound it. He's got a step ahead of the defender. Goes in with the left hand. Nope, little off on the release there that time. Left it on the left side of the iron, and now Elwine will bring it up slowly across half court.
He's just going to the basket almost every time, and if he can get that angle and elevate, he's going to score a lot.
He knows he's got a chance to win some one-on-one battles and has been going to work. Olsen fighting hard inside against a double team. Now that one taken away by Ganey.
That was a great play. Great anticipation by Ganey.
Egg up to the top of the key. Porsche fighting between a double team. Got tangled up. Jump ball. It's going to stay on this end of the floor. That gets us to our media timeout. 4:24 left to go. in this third quarter, 31-27. Watertown took a momentary one-point lead, but Huron back in control.
We all need insurance to protect our health, our homes, our belongings, and our businesses. But coverage is just the beginning. You also need the support of professionals who stand by your side to protect what's important to you. Fisher Rounds and Associates combines the coverage you want with the commitment you need. Fisher Rounds and Associates, at your service, at your side.
Powering the possibilities of tomorrow starts today. For our homes, our farms, our businesses. That's why our Touchstone Energy Cooperative continually plans for the future by utilizing and sourcing safe, reliable power for the next generation. So we can power possibilities long into the future. Touchstone Energy Cooperatives, powering possibilities.
Back inside the Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, AA boys basketball, the Arrows fans. Loving every moment of this tournament. They had that one-point lead, and this place got loud there for a moment. But since then, Huron has settled things down, gone on a 5-0 run. Back to action here. Porish off the front side of the iron. No. Bad for the loose ball, and the Arrows come up with it.
Yeah, he had a good look there at it. Nice play coming out of the timeout for Huron. He had a wide-open look, just a little off the mark.
Engstrom around to the left side. Rodden fighting amongst the trees, couldn't get that one to fall.
Good interior defense there by Colton Ogle.
Yeah. We got a technical, I think, on Watertown's bench.
Pat McClemens thought there was a foul down on the other end.
Things getting heated in this matchup here. It's been a very physical game again. We've seen that 2 days in a row now from here on. And Coach Budenhagen, that's the style of play he likes his guys playing with. Hard-nosed, aggressive basketball. They've been bringing it. And Watertown has matched that here today. This has been a great matchup.
Boy, they're fighting for every rebound.
Huron still at 50% shooting today. 11 of 22 from the field. 2 of 9, though, from three-point land. 64% from the free throw line. Watertown still hovering around 30% from the field today.
What Tigers are doing is they're switching up defenders on Rodden. They're keeping it, you know, they're mixing up their defense. Different players guarding him down every time, it seems like.
Ganey's done a much better job controlling Engstrom as of late. This one with time expiring on the shot clock, left short. A long distance three-point attempt. Now Moting. Scoop pass back outside. Ganey's three, no. Tipped out of bounds. It's going the other way.
Yeah, that was Ogle trying to fight for that rebound. Tipped it away from the Watertown player. Last time down, it was Moting that was guarding Rodden. They'll switch it out. They've had Ganey on him at times, and Elwine, and some of the other players, although they've had Hag on him and Ogle at times. I mean, if you can keep a different look on him, sometimes that throws off an offensive player when he's staring at a different guy. It could be a taller guy, a quicker guy on him, and now Moting draws the assignment in that man-to-man defense for the Tigers.
Watertown 2.5 minutes without any points. Trying to change that here with 18 on the shot clock. 2:45 left to go now in the third quarter. Rodden going up, double-teamed and got fouled. See who it's on. The officials talk it over. There were two possibilities there. I think they're going to get Porish with the personal. That's Anderson Porish.
Yep, his second.
Nothing in major foul trouble concerns right now. We mentioned Kranz for Watertown has the three. Elwine has three on the other side. He's on the bench right now looking on and might very well stay there with Huron in front, at least to the end of this third quarter.
Yep. And for Kranz, he's back out on the floor.
It kind of tells you where the two teams are thinking right now. Huron pushes the lead a little bit further now with 2:38 left to go. Watertown back within two, though. Had a momentary one-point lead before Huron went on that 5-0 run. Watertown has answered. Porish will try to answer with the three of his own. That one no good. Moting went up for the rebound, and there was some contact on the way back down. Looks like it's going to be a foul on Watertown with all that aggressive play there. This might be on Kranz, and if it is, it's his fourth.
Nope, they're going to catch Rawdon with the foul. That's only his first. But, yeah, he was standing right there, and the Watertown fans had a look of concern because they know they can't afford to get Cohen Kranz that fourth foul here with this much time left in the third quarter.
Yeah, 2:23 left to go in the third. You've still got 8 minutes to play in the fourth. Porish goes to the sidelines for just a moment. He may very well be checking back in. Elwine checked back in. He's got those three personal fouls. Two-point game. Crossing him over, going in. Right-handed finish for Blake Elwine.
Boy, and he almost caught an offensive foul there. That left forearm was out in front.
Beauchamp can't get it to go. That's tipped down and loose and out of bounds. They're going to say last touch, though, by Huron. Elwine the last to touch it.
Here comes Porish back in. He was not on the bench very long.
Elwine's going to retreat right back to the sideline. They don't want him to pick up a personal on the defensive side. So kind of playing that defense for offense game a little early, but tells you how important this game is for these two teams here today.
And it also allows him to catch his breath on the sideline too here. He's played a lot of minutes last night and tonight.
Sitting on the sideline with 18 points on 6 of 9 scoring, 8 rebounds today. Second chance opportunity for Caden Beauchamp. The senior has had to work hard to earn his points today. That's a big bucket there to bring him back within two. Jump ball the call. Great defense from the Watertown Arrows. Engstrom got his hands on that one. Sub on the sideline. Rabine will go to the bench. Checking back in is Olson. And also, Huron, they're trying to bring some fresh bodies in. Trace Wenz, the 6'1 junior, checking in.
Yeah, a little quicker lineup in here now for the Tigers as they're going to go with a full court press, but now it backs away, just their straight up man.
McNeil guarding Rodden up the court.
Yeah, again, a different look.
25 seconds on the shot clock, a minute 25 left to go here in this third quarter. Arrows don't need to rush anything. Engstrom lobs it inside. That got tipped away. Ganey got his fingers on it. Now the Tigers off and running. Moten tried to scoop it inside. Wenz didn't see it.
Nope, he wasn't looking.
Rawdon attacking in the interior. He's triple teamed, and it's Porish to take it away. Ganey leading the charge in a 2-on-3 fast break. He'll dump it back outside and alertly brings it out around the perimeter. Under a minute to go now in this third quarter. Moten wants to slow things up with 23 on the shot clock.
Got to figure Porish is option number one.
He'll go to work from the right side of the paint. Double teamed on his way up. That one, no. A foul on the floor here, though. It'll be on Watertown. I think they got Engstrom.
For Engstrom, that's only his first, but that is the 15th foul on Watertown. So McNeil, he has yet to score today. 71% free throw shooter on the season.
Now one off the right side of the iron, misses. Stays a 2-point game here with 45 seconds to go. About a 10 and a half second difference between shot clock and game clock. So still a lot of time. Is that Tinky Winky or which one is it?
I am not sure.
Either way, they're bringing the energy on that sideline today. Huron fans in their space age outfit. Huron, 2-point lead. Watertown on the attack again. Little push off there, no whistle. Play continues on now here. Does come to foul. Lots of physical play between these two teams. And I think they got Porish with the personal.
Yep, and that is his third personal foul. We'll see who comes off the bench. Looks like it's going to be Elwine to replace him.
At the free throw line now. Dylan Rawdon missing off the front side. He'll have one more. The senior will get back with a chance to make this just a 1-point game.
Elwine came in with signaling one, like if we get the ball, we're going to hold for one shot.
It is a 1-point game. They will likely fight for the final shot here with 36 seconds left to go.
Yeah, about 2 second difference.
Rawdon now 11 points today. He leads the charge for Watertown. Elwine back on the floor. He leads them with 18 for Huron.
Yep, Huron's just going to play keep away here. They'll stretch it out.
Fans for Watertown slowly rising to their feet here with 15 on the shot clock, chanting defense. Trying to will this team into the end of the quarter on a high note. Elwine looking to make it 20 points on the day on the attack. Fouled on the way up with three on the shot clock, and he'll go to the line for two.
Yep, Engstrom's going to get the second foul. His two defenders came at Elwine. The contact was made.
Huron has been out in front of this game almost the entire way. It was a momentary one-point Watertown lead at 27-26. Huron pushed it back to a five-point lead. Watertown came storming back. Now it's a two-point game again. Elwine can push it to three with this free throw.
Remember, Huron lost both regular season matchups by double digits.
20 points for the sophomore today. He's two rebounds shy of the double-double. He's been a block machine, but goes to the sidelines again in foul trouble. They'll leave him out for the final 5 seconds. Watertown with pressure in front of him, trying to get it across the front court. Rodden spinning, firing this one off the backside of the iron. Had a chance to go, it does not. Huron will go into the huddle with 8 minutes left to play in this matchup, up by three. We'll go to quarter number four. Be back with more from Sioux Falls in just a moment.
Sometimes having 15 of something is great, like 15 pizzas. Yo! Nice. But for days of class missed, 15 or more is not so great. The best way for students to own their tomorrow is being present today. See why good habits matter at showupsd.com.
Bioethanol supplies more than just energy. It creates jobs in rural communities. It drives demand for local corn. It provides opportunities for family farms to thrive. To ensure agriculture plays a leading role in the efforts to decarbonize and transition energy, bioethanol remains at the forefront of a pursuit for a cleaner, brighter future for all Americans. Learn how at sdethanol.com.
Well, there's Tinky Winky. Whoever watched SDPB and growing up as a kid probably saw the Teletubbies. He's out here having fun today with this Huron crowd. Got the space age thing going on, the aliens.
The NASA suits there. Yeah. I gotta say, I haven't seen that as a theme before, but I like it because I was a big fan of the NASA program growing up. And of course, Sam Gaymeyer, Chuck Gaymeyer as he's known in town, astronaut, NASA astronaut from Scotland.
7:50 left to go as we enter our fourth quarter of action. It's always fun to feel the energy from these crowds, these student sections. They've had a lot to cheer about today with this Huron offense. They've pushed it to a five-point lead now. The Arrows try to respond here. Their first possession of this fourth quarter. Shooting percentage has slowly been going up for this Watertown team, still hovering around 30%. An unforced turnover there, though. That's their 10th of the day.
Watertown outscored Huron 14-9 in that third quarter. All nine Huron points scored by Blake Elwine.
Yeah, he's got 20. 20 on the day, 8 rebounds, 3 blocks, playing with 3 fouls right now. Elwine has turned the ball over 6 times today. That's 6 of their 11 turnovers for Huron. So both teams in double digits in that one category you don't want to be in double digits in. Going to have to take good care of the ball the rest of the way with 7 minutes to go as Porish nearly turned it over. Elwine wants a 3, drains it in front of his own bench, showing the emotion. His 7th made bucket in 10 tries here today. Now foul and an and one. Engstrom has been hot from the floor all day for Watertown. He's got a chance at a 3-point play.
A foul will be on McNeil, his first, and there may have been some jawing going on after that play between McNeil and Engstrom.
And the fans have woken up all over the Sanford Premier Center here in Sioux Falls, starting to really bring some energy on the sidelines these last few minutes. It's a 5-point game. It has been a duke 'em out kind of affair here this afternoon. These two teams have played physical basketball. Full court pressure coming from the Arrows. Gainey tries to get it across the half line and half court line and does. Moting, Gainey playing catch. Now Porish gets in on the action.
Now both teams have been man-to-man pretty much all day today. And Porish just lost the handle. Quick hands by the Arrows defensively.
Yeah, Olsen came in on that help side defense and the double team created the turnover. Now hands it off. Rodden. Guarded closely by Gainey, finds a little separation and scoots in for the finish. Gainey thought he got pushed off. Rodden with a hard-earned bucket.
He's got 13.
Yeah. As far as individual performances today, he's had to work for it. Now 4 of 8 from the field, 5 of 6 at the free throw line, though, leads the Arrows in points scored today. Now blocking foul on Watertown. It's Marcus Rabon trying to man up against Elwine, and that's a size advantage for Elwine as he goes to the line.
Not in the act of shooting, so they'll play it in. Remember, team fouls reset at the quarter break.
Elwine was trying to sell that he got fouled on the way up. They'll say it was on the ground. Gainey driving in, floater left off the rim, no good. Watertown, a chance now to tie this game. They've struggled from three, though, today. 2 of 12 from distance. Overall, up to 34% from the field, though. Rodden steps back, right wing three. He got fouled on the way up. It's on Blake Elwine. He can't believe it, but that's his fourth.
And it should be 3 free throws coming up for Watertown.
Rodden will toe the line. And we mentioned 5 of 6 at the line today as a team. Watertown 11 of 13. Free throws, good defense will keep you in a game. They've had to ride both of those today while they've fought through some three-point shooting struggles. Really struggled to shoot entirely over those first two quarters. Had just 18 points over the first two quarters of action. They've now got 20 points early on here total in this second half, and we're still 5:43 left to go in this fourth quarter.
Yeah, Watertown's been much more in rhythm here in the second half, and the Arrows are going to call timeout.
Well, their fans are making some noise here inside the Denny Sanford Premier Center. It's a 30-second timeout. 40 all your score. The numbers looking good for Watertown here over the last 90 seconds. In fact, it's an 8-0 run over the last minute 11. Been getting it at the line. They've been finding ways aggressively on the defensive side to create some havoc, some turnovers. This Huron team has kind of been playing on their heels the last couple minutes. Still just one player in double figures for Huron, and that's Elwine. 23 of his team's 40 points today. He's come on 7 of 10 shooting. 2 different players now in double figures for Watertown with Rodden. He's got Rodden with 16 and Engstrom with 11. Somebody else for both teams, though. Gonna have to find that guy who steps up and pushes them over the top to get the win here today.
Cohen Kranz, only 3 points. He had 17 yesterday. Is he the man to perhaps step up for the Arrows? And C.J. Gainey has played a good game defensively, but he's been quiet offensively.
Porish will line up the three and connect.
There's another guy who's been relatively quiet, but he knocks down the really long distance three.
He was 0 for 2 from distance before that one. Rodden, fearless inside again amongst the trees, puts it home.
Yeah, he was just bound and determined to score on that play, and he's so quick and can just knife his way through defenders.
Give him 18 points today on 5 of 9 shooting, 8 of 9 at the free throw line. Elwine pretty much shot for shot with him today. 23 points on 7 of 10 shooting. Gives it away to Gainey. He'll connect on the corner three-point attempt. That one did not go, though. Hit off the backside of the iron. Elwine tips this one away into press row. And that goes out of bounds. And we go to our final media timeout of this matchup. 43-42. Huron in front by 1. We're back with more in Sioux Falls in just a moment.
You're committed to building relationships, to exceeding expectations, to serving your community. Your financial partner should share your vision and your values. For 130 years, we've stood by South Dakotans. We've been there, we'll be there. Convenient, connected, committed. Bank West, member FDIC.
The word cooperative means working together for a common purpose. At Actegra Cooperative, we are dedicated to supporting the success of our farmers and the health of our communities for generations to come. Rooted in our communities, Actegra strives to instill dedication, determination, and integrity in everything we do. And that includes inspiring the next generation of agricultural leaders.
.447 left to go in our fourth quarter of action. 43-42 your score. Fans having some fun here on Friday. Watertown fans a little concerned right now. Down by one, but their boys have been battling back throughout this one. Shooting much better. Again, that overall team percentage, Steve, continues to climb. It's now up to 36%. Watertown has outscored Huron 24-17 since halftime.
Yeah, Watertown's been much more in rhythm. They look like a different team here in the second half. Rodden has really stepped up. He only had 4 points at the break. Now he's got 18.
Kranz connects on the three-point attempt. It's a two-point Watertown lead.
That's the man that's really got to step up here in this fourth quarter for the Arrows. He's been held in check so far today.
6 points, four rebounds in 23 minutes for Kranz, and now a foul. Beauchamp trying to get one in a pickpocket move. He'll be picking up the personal foul, though.
Second team foul.
That's his third. Moding goes to work. Rodden in front of him. Gainey trying to isolate him for a moment there on the right side. Instead passes it left. They look now to Elwine, his 23 points on the day. Inside, got tangled up. Double team recovers, though. Still 15 on the shot clock. No need to rush here as Gainey brings it around to the left side again. Elwine cuts in. Drives, right-handed finish, no, got partially blocked by Olsen.
Olsen timed his jump perfectly.
Rodden behind the back dribble, now nearly lost it. Defender goes flying, the three does not connect. The putback hangs and falls. Beauchamp puts it home. Watertown up by four.
Watertown's all the momentum right now.
Strap in, here we go, Kranz, another steal. McNeil in front of him. That one off the glass. No, the foul. And we're going to have two free throws coming up.
McNeil gets his second foul. Boy, just this game, the momentum clearly on the side of the Arrows.
Everything has shifted here in this second half. The Arrows hit a couple big threes after struggling early on. Kranz at the free throw line can't connect here. That's his first free throw attempt of the day. 6 points, four rebounds. Back at the line for another one. Cohen lays it in.
He's 71% shooter on the year. And boy, the momentum is all on the side of Watertown right now. Tigers got to find some answer right now.
Watertown 15 of 18 at the free throw line today. The Tigers have been hovering around 50% shooting from the field today. They're now south of that at 44%, and there's a foul inside. They're going to say on the ground.
Rabine got his third for the Arrows. And that is team foul number three.
2:35 the last time a point was scored for Huron. It's an 8-0 run over the last 2:24 for Watertown. 35 on the shot clock, just under 3 minutes left to go in regulation. Elwine on the attack, spinning inside the lane, double team, passes it down low. That one, nice little scoop shot finish off the glass for Carson Evans.
Big time for that senior to get his first points of the game.
Rodden will try to answer. That one's no good. Elwine with the rebound. That's his ninth, one shy of the double-double now today. Bouncing off a defender. Elwine passes it away. That got tipped by Beauchamp. Now Kranz into the front court. He'll look. Gainey
gets out in front after the steal. He'll go in for the left-handed layup. 1 point game, timeout here on.
For Ganey, his first point since the first quarter. He's played tough defensively, but he has been quiet offensively since then. And again, I've talked about this young man. He's a great player. But when he's really rolling, that's when this Huron team, that's when they're cooking with gas.
Yeah, and his struggles today, 3 of 10 from the field. His only other two makes have come from three-point land, and he hit them early on, as you mentioned, but 8 points on the day now in 25 minutes. Maybe not a bigger play for him, though, this afternoon. As he comes up with the poke, got the steal, the bucket. Now you see fans, they look around. This one-point game, this is about as electric we felt this building in this tournament so far. This has been a fun matchup here on Friday afternoon.
Watertown plus 8 in the rebounding department. Huron with 3 more turnovers at the moment. And the field goal percentage is getting a little bit more even as Huron's kind of struggled from the floor here in the last few minutes. But this is anybody's game. Timeouts. 2 left for Watertown, 4 left for Huron. Team fouls even at 3 each.
Tigers have been in control throughout much of this game. In fact, at halftime, it was 26-18, and it felt like Huron had a chance with a good start in the third quarter to run away with this game early. Not so fast. This Watertown team has come out 30-21 since halftime. Huron fans, they don't look too terribly concerned over there right now. These student sections have brought the energy, the enthusiasm. Now, boy, look. Almost like a football formation on the inbound play there as the Tigers try to bring some extra pressure. Watertown breaks it with ease, and they will settle into their half-court offense with 2 minutes to go. Fans don't like it. Refs let them play on.
Yep, Huron fans calling for a travel. The referee said the ball was touched. It allows the offensive player the extra step. There's a give and go.
Beauchamp got the pass from Krantz. The bucket off the glass, a big one. It's a 3-point lead for Watertown.
What a nice, well-executed play by Watertown.
90 seconds to play. The pass too strong off the fingertips that time of Carson Evans. It's going to go the other way. Watertown with the lead and the basketball now with less than 90 seconds to play. Elwine going to the sideline.
Holden Hegg going to replace him. This is a defensive player in to give the offensive player a rest with 4 fouls.
Yeah, 4 fouls today for Elwine. His 23 points. They're going to need him on the floor perhaps for a last second shot. Watertown wants to push this to a 2 possession lead. They had a 5-point lead a moment ago. They have not led by more than 2 possessions at any point in this game today. Inside, Beauchamp. Fighting hard. That one too strong, though. Hegg throws it off of Beauchamp out of bounds. They're going to say, wow, the way that ends up, it lands right back in the lap of Hegg, who tried to execute one of the harder plays to do. You try to get it off of that defender's leg, but it comes right back to him on a bounce there. Now, whether or not it was on the baseline and out of bounds, I don't know, but a timeout will be called as Watertown takes the break with a full timeout. Minute 4 left to go. Just a 3-point game. That's about the craziest kind of scenario you could ask for there. Watertown, we'll have to see if they can take advantage of it.
Follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Be sure to also to check out all our action and award photos by searching for SDPB on Flickr. Tell us where you're watching us from. Read some of our great stories and watch some of our videos that feature the teams, the players, and the coaches here in South Dakota. Hashtag SDHoops24 at SDPB Sports.
Well, sound the horn. You can hear the trumpets in the background. These fans have been on their feet throughout this timeout. They are ready for the final minute for this one. A 3-point game.
Both teams with a foul to give.
Chance to go to the Consolation Championship on the line. That'll be a 1:45 tip-off against Sioux Falls Jefferson.
This is everything we expected out of this game. Physical, intense, And we got a long way to go in this one, but this is an important defensive stand for the Tigers.
Watertown looking to push this to a two-possession lead now. They'll bring it out with the fresh shot clock. 1 minute left to go. Kranz around to the left side to Beauchamp.
Boating is going to shadow Rodden in the man-to-man for Huron.
Rabine top of the key. There's Kranz again glancing up at the clock for just a moment.
Now they switch to Gainey on him.
15 on the shot clock. Not making his move yet. Porish switching off. Evans watching him go up. That one misses.
Numbers.
About a second difference. Less than that, in fact, in shot clock and game clock. Elwine's three connects.
Oh,
we're tied at 50. Timeout on the floor.
That was a big-time three-pointer.
How many times can you go back to the sophomore and ask him to step up and make a big play? Blake Elwine again connecting, this time from deep, kissing it off the glass. Give him 26 on the day. It's just his second made three. This has been about as efficient a day as you could ask for. Over 28 minutes for Elwine. 26 points, 9 rebounds on 8 of 12 shooting, 2 of 3 from three-point land. He's also connected on 8 straight free throws, and he's tied this game at 50 now with the shot clock turned off. Watertown will have the opportunity, Steve, to take this thing all the way down. They've got a chance for a game-winning bucket. We might see overtime for the first time at the AA State Boys Basketball Tournament. This place is electric right now.
Yep. Both teams with 3 team fouls, so that means Watertown's got a foul to give, so they can be a little more aggressive on defense than one would expect in a situation like this. They can maybe take a chance or two. They've been in man-to-man pretty much all game long. We'll see who comes out on the floor, if Elwine will come out. Yes, he will, with the 4 fouls. So they're gonna put their starting, or 4 of their starters out there. It's like Porish is gonna be on the bench in favor of Holden Hegg. He's a senior defensive specialist for the Tigers. Let's see who comes out for the Arrows. Engstrom's played a lot of minutes this game. He's one of their top scorers at 11 points. It looks like they're gonna have their starting 5 on the court for the Arrows. Both teams, 2 timeouts.
Yep, 2 timeouts left. There are opportunities here. Fouls, each team has 1 to give before we get into free throw situations. It's game on. Light full court pressure.
McNeil guarding Rodden. You gotta figure he's gonna be the man to take that shot.
Here we go, down to the final 15 seconds. Looking to hand it off, not much there. There's Olsen. Gainey in front of him, down to 10 seconds. On the attack now, Kranz driving in. His shot blocked from behind, but a foul with 4.7 left on the clock. Gainey can't believe it. Watertown will go to the line with a chance to take the lead.
McNeil got tagged for that foul. Take a look at it again. You see Gainey trying to get in front of him, but he got around him. Oh, and he just brushed by McNeil.
Going Grant at the line. Started 1-2 today and just about gave everybody in Watertown a heart attack there with that one, but it goes in, and now he'll have another one. 51-50 your score. He's up to 8 points on the day. His second one is good. A cool customer at the line. Timeout called by Huron. They want to talk it over with a full timeout. And Steve, 4.7. That's a lot of time for Huron to get that one across the line. They might have a chance to get one set up. The question is, do you go for the 2, the high percentage shot down low in the tie? You go to overtime and live to fight a battle down the road? Do you go for the win and the glory right now and get a chance at a game-winning bucket? Got to think 3 is a possibility with the way Elwine can score today, but who knows? We'll see what Budenhagen and his crew have set up here in just a moment.
And also for Coach McClements, it's how you deploy your defense. Do you double-team Elwine and try to get the ball out of his hands at all costs? Do you kind of sell out defensively and say, hey, no matter what, You know, number 38 touching the ball. We'll take our chances with any other player, but that can be dangerous because we've seen Ganey hit some three-pointers, and you got to figure Anderson Borish is going to be out there as well, and he can gun it from downtown. With 4.7 seconds in the length of the court to go, you know, you're going to have to go for your first best shot here, and that may be a three-pointer. You might not have a chance to get it down low, but it depends on this entry pass. You want to try to get it at least as close to half court as you can. And remember that Elwine at 6'8", Porish at 6'3", they can elevate and probably get that ball on an inbounds pass and take it away from an arrow defender. And now Coach McClemens, he wanted to see how Huron deployed. It's a little chess game here. He's going to call timeout as these two coaches, veteran coaches here, the chess match. Do you tip your hand or do you go with a decoy on that initial deployment?
There has been one buzzer beater finish in South Dakota from the boys tournament so far. DeSmit got one yesterday. Do we have another one in store for us here in Sioux Falls today? Watertown and Huron have gone punch for punch throughout this one.
Well, the officials heading over to the scores table. I'm not sure why. We're checking the scoreboard here. One timeout left for both squads. Now, another factor, Watertown has a foul to give. So it's if a foul on the floor, that doesn't hurt them. So if they say get beat, you know, if they get beat on a play, as long as the shot is not going up, they can commit a foul, and that may take valuable seconds away and an opportunity away from Huron.
Anxious faces on the fans in the stands. Coach Buttenhagen has been in the ear of the officials this entire timeout, and I think he just got teed up. That's the one thing you didn't need right there for Huron. Coach Buttenhagen just gotten a technical foul.
I am not sure why. You know, one of the officials was checking on something, and I'm not sure what the call was.
The coaches are trying to figure out something within the timeouts and wondering if Watertown had any left. And I think that's what they're getting upset about. And Coach is in the ear of the officials, is now free throws. Push this to a three-point game. What a turn of events here.
Again, they're on the far side of the court from our broadcast location, so we couldn't hear what was going on as the two free throws are made to potentially put this one out of reach.
So now it's a four-point lead for Watertown.
And Watertown gets the ball.
Yep, that's the big kicker in this whole scenario, is now Watertown has the ball. A timeout will be called. 54-50 is your score. Timeout as both teams trying to get collected. And again, the Huron coaching staff trying to be restrained here on the sideline.
And again, I don't know if it was a substitution infraction or what was going on. Now, one of the assistant coaches talking to the official, Coach Buttenhagen there in the ear of one of the officials and assistant coach there.
Boy, and it escalated so quickly, too. It was just they checked something on the sideline. The coaching staff for Huron didn't like what they heard, and they tried as hard as they could to try to keep the head coach of this Huron team settled down. But Tim had made up his mind and was going to go after him. Tough, tough spot to have that happen, though. Two-point game turns into a four-point game, and now Watertown gets the ball with 4.5 seconds left.
We're right in front of our broadcast location where Watertown throws it in.
That one got tipped out of bounds. Still Watertown basketball. And right in front of our cameras here, Olsen will try to get this one in for the Arrows. Tigers fighting for a turnover.
Five-second
runoff, and it'll be Tigers basketball. 3.7 left on the clock. Hope not lost yet. Two-possession game. You got to hope for something short of a miracle here. You got fouled on the three. That one off the glass. That should be free throws here. Beauchamp thought he fouled him before the shot went up, but the Tigers will get three free throws here now.
with 1.9 seconds left. You got to figure, make the first two, intentionally miss the last one, try to get the rebound.
Here's Elwine with his 26 points today. 8 of 8 at the free throw line, and he misses his first.
And that is, that really hurts the Huron cause.
Second one coming up. This is off the glass and in. He's got one more to go. Now, there is still a possibility of stealing the inbound, getting fouled, getting a shot up. Hope not completely lost yet here for this Huron team. This next free throw, big one though, as Elwine toes the stripe again. Goes off the rim. Ganey got it. They throw it back out. The shot didn't get off in time. It went in, but it gets waved off. It does not go at the end, and they will, I believe, review this one. But that got put up from what it looked like from our seat, Steve, after the lights on the backboard illuminated. We'll see here.
Can't see from
that
angle.
Yeah, from that angle. You can see the
bank in.
Yep. What a wild conclusion to this game. As of right now, the score on the scoreboard would read 54-51. If they count that bucket, we would go to overtime. You could see his feet hadn't left the floor. The ball hadn't been released when the lights went up. So close there at the end. Ganey got the pass away. Moting connects, but after the clock had expired, the officials.
From my eye, just watching in real time, I thought the light was on and the shot went up too late.
One of the craziest finishes we have seen at the state tournament.
I mean, this is just bizarre with the technical foul on the coach, the turnover, and then the three-point shot being put up. I mean, this is just about as crazy as it gets, but I think, just watching in real time, I think it went up too late. And this has been a reason why we have the instant replay here to go over situations like this. We remember that a few years ago at the AA tournament. No count, it won't count.
Watertown will win this game 54-51. It's in the books and final. A crazy way to finish up this matchup here today. A hard-fought battle for these two teams, but for the first time in 9 years, the Watertown Arrows have won a game at a state tournament. We will take a timeout and recap the second half of this one and try to put a conclusion together on what has been an exciting first half of our second day at the state tournament. We'll be back with more in just a moment.
You live life on the move. While you determine what direction that may be, we're here to help along the way. So go. Go with values. Go with friends. Go with support. Go with convenience.
The most gratifying thing about what I do day in and day out is I get to watch things grow.
When you look at corn and the huge role it plays in feed for our cattle and our livestock, our pigs, is so huge. Also our ethanol plants.
I sit on South Dakota Corn Growers Association. We're focused on policy, so we work with state representatives as well as our state senators and our representative in Washington.
Lucky for us, life is full of choices, big and small, just as it should be. They define us, make us who we are. And when it comes time for you to choose, a car, home, your next big adventure, or start a new business, Farmers Union Insurance has the variety of choices to make sure you have the perfect coverage to protect each perfect moment. Farmers Union Insurance.
Jackrabbits don't wait to see what the future holds. They build it. At South Dakota State University, the next generation's leaders are preparing to launch. They're focusing on growth, and they're reaching new heights of excellence across vital industries. SDSU is building something greater for South Dakota and the world.
back in Sioux Falls, taking a look at the final sequence again. It comes off a missed free throw off the front side of the iron. Gainey got it, kicked it out to Moding, Steve. You can see those lights came on before the ball ever left his fingertips. It ends up banking in. It would have tied the game at 54. What a crazy finish to this one. It comes off the heels of a technical foul on the Huron coach right at the end after some sort of disagreement with the referees. We haven't gotten clarification yet what the disagreement was, but it turned into what was a 4-point lead for Watertown. They got the free throw at the line to make it the 3-point game. Had that one went in as it expired, would have been bedlam in here, but it ends up being a Watertown 54-51 win over Huron in what was a physical second half of basketball.
Yeah, they remember that Huron had the lead at the break, but the Arrows, they got their rhythm established on offense as Kranz hits that three-pointer, and there's the drive. Elwine, what a superb day with 27 points. Porsche, that was a big three-pointer for the Tigers, but Kranz got a couple of late threes. Those were big difference makers. Rebound fought for. That was a big one by Beauchamp late in the game as he was working hard on the glass. Gainey had a good game defensively. Had a big layup there. Here's a big three that made it close. And then the free throws at the end. Kranz hit a couple of them. You had the technical foul, and here's that mad scramble. You can hear the horn clearly sound while the ball was still in his hands. And it would have counted had it been a half a second earlier. A bizarre finish to this game in Watertown. There you see the numbers. 3-point shooting, not good for the Arrows today, but they won the battle on the boards, and they had four fewer turnovers in the game. And they played a much better second half. They scored 36 points in the second half compared to 25 for Huron. As Huron won the first half, Watertown won the second half and the game.
Second chance points were huge for Watertown in this game. 8 points in second chance opportunities. Their bench had 11 points today after not scoring a single point in yesterday's game. Big part of their victory here today. The 14th win of the season for Watertown, their first in 9 years. Took that long just to get back to the state tournament. Now they've got one in the books. They'll try to make it two tomorrow. We'll talk more about that when we come back as we preview our evening matchups and beyond at the AA state tournament.